Brothers, how are y'all doing this Sabbath day? It was kind of good to be back until it started snowing again. And I don't like snow. I'm too old to be shoveling that daggone snow. So I was out. I visited our brothers and sisters in Alabama. They were in good spirits. From Alabama, I went to Atlanta where I fellowshiped with them from Friday and Saturday. That's what I did. I went to the airport in Atlanta Sunday morning. The airport shut down for 2 days, Lava. 2 days, the airport had no power. I was mad as hell. Drove to North Carolina. I said, I'm going to fly from there. So I met up with Captain Kazak, Officer Dakar, and Officer Eli and them, and Officer Soraya. And I decided to stay out there for about a week, so I stayed out there. My wife was upset and angry, but she get over it. She goes, I hope you ain't got no girlfriend out there. Oh, shut up. Got no daggone girlfriend. I'm too old for that stuff. So came back. Good to be back. So when I came back, I heard news that a brother got injured. You, Deacon Asaph, and Deacon Ithan went to visit the brother. You want to speak on that?
Shalom, family.
Shalom.
Yes, we have received word that a brother and his wife, they were injured in a car accident. We learned about it last week. We actually went to the hospital. It was the same hospital that Deacon Asaph was in. With his daughter, and the family that was injured bumped into Deacon Asaph within the building. Well, Deacon Ithan, he's here. Deacon Ithan actually knows him. So we went to pay a visit to the brother and his family inside the hospital because the objective is that we have to learn how to eliminate the petty foolishness between us and keep God's commandments. That's what I mean, the camps. You got different camps that are about literally trying to destroy each other. And we have a bigger enemy than that. So, you know, it's amazing that that situations like this cause you to think outside of the Israelite box, I should say. The Israelite box will cause you to look at petty differences where there's hatred, where you can't even see that a real need is there. There's a situation, and I mean we actually sat with the sister, which is the wife of the brother. The brother actually teaches at a camp on 149th Street, correct? Near Deacon Ithan's camp. And I think it was snowing the night of the situation. They got in a very bad accident, and the legs of both of them were injured pretty bad. I won't go into the details completely about what it was, but I will say that in these moments, we have to come together and come away from the stupid divisions that divide us, and look at the commonality, if you will. You know, we're all Israel. And there's a family that's in need, so we wanted to do our part to try to bring some unity among the camps, at least in terms of that. We know there's going to be differences in terms of doctrines and small things, but something at that magnitude, who would they turn to? You know, when the scripture speaks about love thy enemies, that's what it's really talking about. It ain't talking about loving Esau and the white folks. It's talking about how do you deal with your own people that may not see eye to eye with you on certain things. But if you deal right with them, according to what Christ said, you may get them to turn around. And that's the point in that. So, Deacon Ithon and Deacon Asaph, they can speak more about it. Deacon Ithon, you want to speak on that real quick?
At the end of the day, we got to show that, yeah, man, who's their big, who's their big brothers are. You understand? We're not going to let our differences put us away from helping a brother or helping a sister. Because at the end of the day, like Deacon just said, we still family. You understand?
And it's good that we have that mindset, because Christ said, "Hereby shall men know you are my disciples if you have love one for another." That's the evidence if you're a true disciple of Christ. When you let your petty differences, okay, come and sow hatred in the body, that's how you're not a disciple of Christ. Give me that scripture in 1 Corinthians 13 about face-to-face, okay? See, all of the petty differences we have, I won't say so much petty, but the differences, I'll say differences in the doctrines of the various camps. This is what the scriptures say about that. You know what I want, Captain Isaac?
First Corinthians 13 and 12. For now we see through a glass darkly.
The glass that we see through darkly is the Bible, meaning we don't know everything. Many of the scriptures in the Bible, as I've showed y'all, have what? Double meanings, okay? So it says, for now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face, meaning Christ is going to deal with us face to face in the wilderness and clear all the confusion up. So why are we hating one another? This is what some Israelite leaders in camps cannot comprehend.
Even in a time of serious need like this.
Exactly. Even in a time of serious need. So it says, but then face to face, read on.
Now I know in part.
We know in part. Go ahead. But anybody that says they know everything, they're not men of the Most High. Leave them alone. You've been warned. Leave them alone. Go ahead.
But then shall I know even as also I am known.
But then shall I know even as also I am known. Meaning the Lord knew us from the beginning. Before he said, let there be light, we were there. He knew us. Okay? He's the creator. So from there, give me Ezekiel 20, and I think it's verse 35. Ezekiel 20, to show you the same thought, show you the precept for it. Right. Ezekiel 20 and verse 35. Can you put us up on the thing? Thank you. I appreciate you.
Ezekiel chapter 20 and verse 35. And I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there will I plead with you face to face.
That's the same thing Paul revealed to us. He said the Lord is going to deal with us face to face. Christ is going to be in the wilderness with us face to face. So whatever little doubts or confusions in our mind, he said, I'm going to clear it up for you. This is the understanding. He's going to show us everything like he did Moses. Let me say it again. He's going to show us everything. Show. He ain't going to just talk. Like when he gave the history to Moses, he didn't tell Moses. He showed Moses. Like we look at a TV show, like y'all looking right now on the screen. You see me? We look at Esau's little electronics. Oh, we can look. We can see. And Esau does his little creations with Adam and Eve and create all that BS. Most I say, I'm going to show you how it really went down. He's going to open our mind, our spirit, and say, I'm going to show you. I'm going to open a doorway so you can see for yourselves, and we're going to see everything. We're going to see the great men of Israel, Samson. We're going to see Deborah. We're going to see Judith. We're going to see Abraham, Isaac, and we're going to know who they are. Look, they got the same face, that brother right there and that sister. Wow. We're going to see it. So there ain't going to be no confusion. All the little arguments we had on this side is going to be all done and gone. Okay?
You know, Bishop, you know, like the scripture said, all we ask brothers to do, we might teach difference, right? But at least there have to be a respect between every camp. You understand? You cannot just trash a brother, just talk about his family, this and that nature. Then you expect love from that brother. That's that hatred we have to remove from us. You understand? Christ make the parable about the Pharisee and the Republican. You understand? He's saying that, would you salute that who only that you knew or the person you don't know? You understand? Us doing what we're doing, we're trying to fit the scripture. We're trying to fit the scripture. Whatever the scripture said, that's what we're going to do. You understand? But a lot of you move out of emotion. You understand? We're not supposed to move out of the emotion, how you feel, how you think. Let's do what the scripture said. Help one another and respect one another. You understand? That's what we're trying to build here, man. Who's the better man?
Exactly. All praises. Today we're going to discuss heroes and villains. Heroes and villains. Now, I want to open up with, before we get into the topic, I want to go to Matthew. No, you know what I want? No, you get me Matthew 24. I'll start there. Matthew, and after I show this video that we're going to look at, I want you all to see, there's a video I want. They got these two little black kids called Angels Among Us. Little black kids, I think they're African. I'm not sure. I think it's Africans. And they go, they waving their hand and everybody. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Find me that stupid little video. I've got to talk about them. I just got to talk about these kids. And oh, no, he's getting on the children. They ain't, they're demons. Demons on assignment. I'm going to tell y'all straight. All right. Give me Matthew 24. hate. Matthew 24. Let me show y'all something. And verse 24, Captain Isaac. Read me that.
Matthew chapter 24, verse 24. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect.
So, notice what Christ says. There shall arise false Christs. False Christs. Like you got the false image of Jesus. That's the false Christ. And false prophets. Who can give me a modern name for the word prophet? Modern name. It's the same meaning. Same meaning. I'm going to see who's thinking. Raise your hand. Prophet. False prophet. I want a modern name for the word prophet. In the back on my left.
Shalom, leadership, Brother Josedek.
Brother Josedek, shalom. Go ahead.
Preacher.
What did you say?
Preacher.
Yes, preacher. The word preacher means to foretell. That's prophet. Preacher is the modern day word for prophet. Okay? Like when the scriptures call Solomon the preacher. Okay? When you read in Romans, is it chapter 10 or 11? How shall he hear 10 without a preacher? Meaning without a prophet. And these preachers you got today, they are not prophets of the Lord. Read the scripture for me again.
Matthew 24, verse 24. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect.
That verse is not talking about these stupid, evil Christian faith healings. It ain't talking about that. The proof, I'm going to prove everything that I'm saying. Watch this. It says, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Let's get the elect in Isaiah, not you. Isaiah, is it 45 and 3 or 44 and 3, something like that? Find me that.
Isaiah chapter 45 and verse 4. For Jacob my servant's sake and Israel mine elect.
So you new brothers and sisters, write that down. The elect that Christ was making reference to is Israel. The elect is not all nations that believe in Jesus. That's a lie. The elect are the Israelites. So let's go back to Matthew 24:24. I want this to marinate in our brains. Go ahead.
For there shall arise false Christ and false prophets, mm-hmm. and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect.
So again, I'm reading it again for the third time, because we often assign that verse to faith-healing Christians. But notice it says, shall show great signs and wonders. Great signs and wonders. Those are the two words we want to highlight. Watch this. Give me Revelation chapter 13. Let's see what these great signs and wonders are. Revelation 13, and let's start at verse 13.
Revelation chapter 13, verse 13. And he doeth great wonders.
See that word? Wonders. And he doeth great wonders. He's going to explain.
So that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men.
Write this down. 1945, the dropping of the atom bomb. The two bombs they dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki were called Little Man and Fat Boy. That was their names. That's when they said fire fell from heaven. Read.
And deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles.
Notice what it's calling the calling of fire from heaven. That wonder is calling it. What's the word it said?
Miracles.
Miracles. Why? Because it's never been seen before. Okay. See, a lot of times we read the Bible and we like to keep it mythic or mythologic. Oh, the Bible is just so mythical. No, it's not. Right. It's intangible. So in your Christian mind, you walk around waiting for some idiot with 3 sixes in the back of his neck to go, hum de la baka kaka, and fire come down from heaven. That's not happening. Then when you see the white man drop bombs and kill hundreds of thousands of people, you go, that can't be in the Bible. No. Then when we tell you, you're like, is that really what it's talking? That's really what it's talking about. Read it again.
Verse 14. And deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast.
Now you read the word beast and you go, see, it's a three-headed, seven-headed monster. Growl, growl, growl. Give me the precept for beasts in Ecclesiastes, please. You know where it is, Isaac? You know, I'll be forgetting. 4:16, something like that. Thank y'all. See, I forgot. 3:18. Here we go.
Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 18. I said in mine heart concerning the estate of the sons of men, that God might manifest them, and that they might see that they themselves are beasts.
So the sons of men are beasts. So you read in the book of Revelation about beasts, and you're thinking of a literal monster, a Godzilla and King Kong. No, it's talking about men. Okay, so. Yes, go ahead.
Y'all heard when the bishop just read the thing out of Revelation and he made reference, because it's true, about the bombs being dropped in Nagasaki and Hiroshima in 1945, right? And he caused fire to come down from heaven. And our people have been taught this mysticism about the Bible. Then when you go into the Bible and actually point out that it's literally talking about something that is tangible to our existence, this is history that we all know about. Why the main reason why people reject that is because once you start bringing facts to the Bible, it by default leads to you must change. Because once you start proving that the Bible is real, that means the commandments in the Bible also are real and you need to apply those. By keeping it mystical, you can say, oh, well, you know, I don't really believe in the Bible anyway because it's about mysticism and all of that, and I can stay in sin.
Exactly. And when you read this, like we just read it, it's going to prove the white man is the devil, the Bible speaks. And you go, oh, no, not my master, not my master. That's the typical Negro mind. Now watch this. Read again.
Verse 14, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles.
So those wonders are called miracles, okay?
Which he had power to do in the sight of the beast.
In the sight of men, the white man, go ahead.
Saying to them that dwell on the earth, that they should make an image to the beast.
Now, this goes back historically. They made an image in honor of the white man in the 1400s. Leonardo da Vinci was hired by the Roman Catholic Church, by Pope Alexander VI of Rome, to paint his son, Cesare Borgia, the second son of Pope Alexander VI. They painted him as the Renaissance image of Jesus. And everyone worships that guy. Read it again.
Saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live.
Remember, Rome fell 193 AD. They were resurrected during the time of Renaissance. That's how they lived again. Read verse 15.
And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast.
The life they gave that false image of Jesus is the life of Christ. Because it was really who? Cesare Borgia. They said, don't call him that no more. You will call him Jesus. Go ahead.
That the image of the beast should both speak.
How does that image speak? There's science. There are TV shows and all that. They hire actors that look just like Cesar Borgia. Like, what's the little Edomite's name? Mel Gibson did a movie called Passion of the Christ. They found an actor that looks very similar to Cesar Borgia and said, now he goes, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten. So that's how the image speaks. And yep. People in the theater crying.
Right, exactly.
Negroes crying in the theater. Some of you in the theater. You, some of y'all was in the theater crying.
I know they were. Y'all ever wonder, just like what the bishop is bringing out, to show you the tangibility again of the scriptures in our reality. You notice that they don't use, like you said, they don't bring just any Edomite. Right. They don't get Ben Affleck, right. Robert De Niro. They don't get those kind. They get the one that looked just like the historical figure Cesar Borgia.
Exactly.
That's not by accident.
Exactly. We don't?
And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast.
So they gave Cesar Borgia the life of Christ. Write that down. Read.
That the image of the beast should both speak.
Through their media, it speaks. Go ahead.
And cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed.
During the time of slavery, if we didn't worship that white image of Jesus, they murdered us. They slaughtered us. This is how our mothers and fathers all became Christians from the time of Columbus. If we did not worship that image, they murdered us. They slaughtered us. They burned us alive at the stake. So now give me 1 Timothy 6 and 20, please. So we're still dealing with the signs, wonders, and miracles that we thought was talking about faith healing, but it's not talking about that. It's talking about the science of this white man. Go ahead.
1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 20. O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science falsely so-called.
See that? And oppositions of what? Science. Because science opposes God. How so? If you want to be healed, you're sick, you got a rheumatism, arthritis, whatever, who do you go to? The white man. Say, Mr. White Man, can you give me some medicine? And the white man gives you medicine for your rheumatism, arthritis, or your diabetes, whatever it is. The white man's science is what heals us today. You're missing a leg? The white man says, don't worry, I can give you a new leg. He gives you a prosthetic limb. Or a new arm. Wow, this white man is fantastic. White man said, oh, I got much more than that, young man. You want to go flying from one state to another, one country? I got something called an airplane. I am God. Then he said, oh, not only that, I can get to the moon. You want to travel from here to yonder? I can get there. 1969, I created the first moon landing. I did that thing. I got satellites going from here to Venus and Mars even. I am God. So this is what happens. So now back to Matthew 24 again. Matthew 24, verse 24.
Matthew 24, verse 24. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect.
They're false prophets. I remember when JFK made the alleged prophecy. He said, we shall be the first to land on the moon. And sure enough, it happened. And they said they prophesied that thing. And they said the eagle has landed, like it says in the book of Obadiah, because they know the scriptures. So these things are signs and wonders. Now, let's go to the video with your friend in mind, the white man from, I think he's from Turkey, if I'm not mistaken, Benny Hinn. H-I-N. My mama used to watch this dude. Not this video. Benny Hinn. I sent you the video. Okay. All we're going to look at is probably the first 5 minutes. And I need you, the volume is low, so I need you to turn it up in the back. Turn up the volume on this. This is about faith healing. Watch. Look at Benny Hinn caught on camera stealing exposed. This is part three. They did a whole series on this dude and other faith healers. Go ahead.
Benny has had an answer for it. He's claimed that only those healings that are medically verified are broadcast on his television program. He said that many times, like this.
There's five stages of our follow-up where we call the doctor and say, were they sick? And then we verify these healings.
She hasn't been able to walk up steps.
So we thought we'd put that miracle verification to the test. Last summer, Benny Hinn held services in Toronto, filling the Air Canada Center three times in just 24 hours, declaring dozens of miraculous healings. A few weeks later, the highlights of that Toronto crusade were shown around the world on his TV show.
Dr. Mahery, These are the ones you called out with AIDS, Pastor.
My God.
HIV.
You devil of AIDS, come out of them in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. You come out of them. You come out. I said come out. Come
Those
out.
Miracles included people he proclaimed cured of AIDS.
Fill my cup. That cancer goes in Jesus' name.
Of cervical cancer.
This is Lisa. You called out tonight.
Of diabetes. The ministry declined to talk to us on camera, so we set out to track down those healings ourselves. We were independently able to find four of the people declared miraculously healed by Benny Hinn in Toronto. Remember, Hinn insists all those healings are medically verified. This woman declined to talk to us. Of the others, it turns out the woman declared cured of cervical cancer didn't have cancer in the first place, but something called mild dysplasia, a change in cell structure that her doctor is monitoring. Since the crusade, this woman's diabetes actually got worse, and she was hospitalized. And according to her latest medical test, the woman in the center still has AIDS. So what really is going on here? Is it mass deception? Mass hypnosis? From his research, Justin Peters believes this.
It's a matter of mind over body. And for a while, you can make yourself believe that you are healed and you feel better for a little while until the euphoria subsides, a new day dawns, and the symptoms almost always reappear.
In fact, remember those so-called miracles we told you about earlier? Well, it turns out they weren't quite what Pastor Benny said they were either. The Mayo Clinic determined that boxer Evander Holyfield never had a heart condition. He'd been misdiagnosed. Little William's eyesight is still damaged. And according to his family, 3 years later, he hasn't seen a penny from any ministry trust fund. And shortly after I spoke with her, Belva Ventura died of cancer.
All these faith healing, and the majority of the people there is women. Because women always want a quick fix. They don't want to change their diet. They say, my mom used to get this bottle of water. Send $25 for some damn water from some of these damn devils. The toilet bowl water. And say, what is that water? This is holy water. I'm going to get here. I said, mama, that water is garbage. It ain't going to do nothing. Shut up, boy. You don't know what you're talking about. You still sick, right, mama? Shut up, boy. So that's what happens. All these faith healings is fake. Okay. One woman still had AIDS. Other one still got diabetes. Got worse. The diabetes got worse. And if I'm not mistaken, they did a movie on it, a spoof by Steve Martin.
Something Faith. That's the name of it. Something Faith. The Faith is in the name of it.
Leap of faith.
That was it. That was
right.
It.
They did an actual movie on this documentary. So y'all could go home, put it on Netflix. It's on there. Get a good laugh.
Relax. Cherry Hat, Section 4, Row F.
You, sir, in the brown jacket. I feel a burden you're carrying.
Who, me?
Yes, sir. Now stand up and tell me if I'm hearing the Lord right. You're having a problem with your neighbor, am I right?
I sure am.
Building a fence gonna harm your kids, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, the Lord tells me
amazing.
The best
way to
get rid of an enemy is you make them your friend. You talk to them and serve them up your best fried chicken. Because yours is the best in the county, ain't it, ma'am?
You know it is.
Well, boy, I'd love to give me some of that. Now come on up and thank the Lord for his saving.
Section 5, row A is the glitter jeans. Remember glitter jeans?
Sister, you're suffering deeply. You're worried about your little girl, aren't you?
Yes, Reverend.
Stand up, darling.
The Lord tells me that a strike unto any of his children is like a strike unto him.
Lord, I hear you. Please forgive me.
Well, Jesus forgives you. Now say hallelujah.
Fishing cap, section 4, row out.
You, sir, come up on stage and be cured of your gambling.
Why, that's incredible. Section 1, pink moo-moo. She lost her job at the mill.
And you, ma'am, in the nice pink dress, receive the Lord and you will find another job.
Section 3, first row, the white shirt, back problem.
And you, sir, believe in the Lord and cure your backache.
Same section, yellow shirt, hearing problem.
And you, sir, in the yellow shirt, come on up on stage.
Hearing problem. Section 2, the blue-haired lady, she's got arthritis.
And you too, ma'am, come on up on stage. help some people tonight.
Then now you got the Negroes want to get into this thing. Put me two little Negro boys in Africa. I don't know if they're ham or shem, but I don't know. They get on my nerves regardless. Watch this. Put it big. I want to see it on the screen. Now stop. Don't play nothing. When you see people fall back, they call that being slain in the spirit. Like when Paul fell off the horse going the road to Damascus, it's called slain in the spirit. BS. Total BS. Watch. And enslaved.
Now we sitting here, we look at it, we know this is BS, and we laugh when we see it. But just think about the people that's watching this that really believe in that food.
Giving all their money out.
Giving all their rent money, everything.
Everything.
No food, no nothing.
Some sisters have almost gone homeless.
Right.
Not y'all up in here, mind you. Some women have almost gone homeless, sent all their money.
Right.
Trying
to quote what's in there about the woman that gave a penny, the last penny, all she had. Yeah. That ain't what this is about here.
Yeah, exactly. If you do a research on these pastors from Africa, they're the richest pastors. They're worth 100 something million dollars a year. They'd make TV Jake and Kifo Dollar work for them. That's how much money they're pocketing from Africa.
They make a lot of money. That's the get-quick-rich scheme. That's what it is. So now, we're going to follow up with heroes and villains. One of the attributes of the villain, every story has a hero, every story has a villain, okay? When you're the villain often portrays himself as the hero in the story. No matter where you go, you'll read about this, and a villain says, no, I'm the hero. That's what they do. Even during the time of Samson, when you read about the history of our forefather Samson, when he was conquered by the Philistines rejoiced, and they portrayed themselves as great men of Dagon, the heroes who brought down the Israelite pagan. That's what they were saying. So now, there's an Edomite named Joseph Campbell. Joseph Campbell, when I was in college, we had to watch films from different countries to see how they filmed. We had to watch and see the techniques of writing. And there's one thing in Hollywood they always say. They say, if you want to become a good writer, every Hollywood writer must read the Bible if you want to be a good writer. Like you got George Lucas, you got Steven Spielberg. They're like the two of Hollywood's best. Even Cameron. These guys, they take the history of the Bible and alter it, like with Return of the Jedi. The word Jedi is simply a play on words for Judah. That's all it is. When you must portray the fruits of the spirit, or you have the works of the flesh. Remember in Darth Vader, what was his name, Darth Vader? Anakin Skywalker. He put forth works of the flesh, hatred, envy, jealousy, all those negative things brought forth his dark side, as they call it, dark side. And the Jedi or Judah, that's what they were called, they had to have forth the fruits of the spirit. So now, there's an Edomite named Joseph Campbell. I'm going to show his film. Did I send y'all his film? It says Heroes and Villains. It's a video, short video. Don't show it. I just want to know, do you have it? That one, I sent you another one. Did I send you another one? Yes, that one right there. Yes. Bear with me. Don't play it yet. So now, let me stop. Every story, whether history or our story, okay, there is one common plot called a hero's journey. That's what Joseph Campbell discusses, the hero's journey. The hero, he put it in 12 stages, but I'm just going to shorten it down in the scriptures and show you where he got all this from. They say, oh, he studied many myths and mythology, but in this video they omitted that he studied the Bible, which I know that's what he studied. The best writers in Hollywood, as I said, they all want to become good writers. They have to read the Bible. Our story, which is recorded in the Bible, is the best of all. We rise to righteousness, we fall to sin, and the Lord from heaven sends us a Savior, and we win. That is the theme of what the Bible is about. And I'm going to show that it's true, and that's the end. I'm going to show that is what it's about. So I made it simple, and I'm going to help y'all. I made it very, very simple. I want to start with, give me Sirach 33. Let's start there. Sirach 33, 14 and 15. I want to show you that the Bible is about righteousness, unrighteousness, heroism, and villainism. That's what the Bible's about. And guess what? We might right now look like the villains of the story because that's how the media portrays us. And a white man is the savior of mankind. But, oh, they have done an excellent job in their persuasive tactics. We are truly the hero of the story. And I'm going to prove that to you today. Give me that. Sirach 33, 14 and 15.
Sirach 33, verse 14. Good is set against evil and life against death.
Good is set against evil and life against death. Come on.
So is the godly against the sinner.
So is the godly against the sinner.
And the sinner against the godly.
And the sinner against the godly.
So look upon all the works of the Most High.
Look upon everything the Lord has done.
And there are two and two.
Two and two. Good against evil. Righteousness against sin. Go ahead.
One against another.
One against another. Okay, from there. Let's go back to the very beginning. Genesis 3. I'm gonna give you a what is it called? A prologue. Is that the beginning, the prologue, before you read the introduction of where it began? Let's go to Genesis 3. This is prelude or prologue. I'm going to go back to the beginning, and we're going to identify the hero. We're going to identify the villain. So all you at home, you Christian apologetics, I know you looking. I know you watching. Watch this, Genesis 3:15.
The book of Genesis, chapter 3, verse 15. And I will put enmity.
I will put hatred.
Between thee and
between thee, meaning Satan.
And the woman.
And the woman. Now this woman here, it's hip talk. It refers to the sons of God. Hold on, let me prove that statement. Give me Jeremiah 6. What verse is it? Yes, give me that. I'm going to prove to you about the woman. Some Israelite brothers, BHI, in the Sanacronym, Black Hebrew Israelites, they can't see beyond their nose. So they see the woman and they go, oh, it's talking about the woman is God and God is making enmity between Satan and the actual black woman. No, it's going beyond the black woman, foolish one. Read that for us.
Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 2. I have likened the daughter of Zion to a comely and delicate woman.
So the daughter of Zion is referring to the nation of Israel. Let's go back now.
Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman.
And I will put enmity, meaning hatred, between thee and the woman. He's talking to Satan. That's what he's talking to. Go ahead.
And between thy seed.
Between thy Satan's seed.
And her seed.
And her seed, meaning Israel. Okay, was that it?
It shall bruise thy head.
It shall bruise thy head.
And thou shalt bruise his heel.
And thou shalt bruise his heel. Now that's the part we want to highlight. Thou shalt bruise his heel. Let's get a little deeper. Give me Genesis 25 now. We just read the prophecy. Now as we read further on, in Genesis, you read the beginning of the fulfilling of that in Genesis 25. Let's start at verse 21.
Genesis chapter 25 and verse 21.
Uh-huh.
And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren.
Now, it was always a shame for the woman to be barren. A woman, it was her goal to eventually become a wife and become a mother. It was a shame to separate a wife from mother. It was always their goal because that's what they was created for. Oh, I know, sisters, the white man has changed that around and said, no, you put your career first. But no, the Lord said you are to be a mother, okay? And brothers, we're to be fathers. That's our job. Read again.
And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren. And the Lord was entreated of him. And Rebekah, his wife, conceived.
She got pregnant. Go ahead.
And the children struggled together within her. And she said, if it be so, why am I thus?
If the Lord has blessed me with children, why am I thus?
And she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb.
Two nations. This is the beginning of two nations, which is in the womb of the black woman, Rebekah. Go ahead.
And two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels.
Now the Lord is telling them, two manner, meaning two different types of people, shall be separated. Go ahead.
And the one people shall be stronger than the other people.
One of those boys is going to be the father of a great and mighty nation that shall endure great hardships. Go ahead.
And the elder shall serve the younger.
And the first boy that's born is destined, listen good, the first one that's born is destined to be a slave in the coming kingdom. Because that's what it's talking about. Read.
And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb.
And we know they were not identical because it said two manner of people shall be separated. So they were what? Fraternal. Go ahead.
And the first came out red all over like in hairy garment.
Now it gives you the color of the first baby. That first one was red, like we call them down south, redneck crackers, we call them. But it ain't just their neck that's red. They're red from the top of their head to the tip of their toes. They're red. They laugh too hard, they get red. They stand in the sun too long, they get red. You pop them upside their head, they get more red. They are red. Go ahead.
And they called his name Esau.
Right, go ahead.
And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel.
Uh-oh. Go ahead.
And his name was called Jacob. And Isaac was 80 years old when she bare them.
So what we want to highlight here, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel. Go back to Genesis 3:15. I don't want y'all to forget the thought. His hand took hold on Esau's heel.
Genesis 3:15. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head.
It bruised thy head, which was Christ.
And thou shalt bruise his heel.
But our people shall bruise their heel. That began here in Genesis 25, verse 26. Now let's get the understanding of that in 2nd Esdras, chapter 6, verse 7 through 9. So what does it really mean, taking hold on the heel? Well, the prophet Esdras breaks it down for us. We ain't got to do a lot of guesswork. He did it for us. He explains it through the angel. Go ahead.
2nd Esdras, chapter 6. And verse, you want to start at 8 or 9?
7.
Verse 7. Then answered I and said, what shall be the parting asunder of the times? Or when shall be the end of the first and the beginning of it that followeth?
So the question he's asking, when shall be the end of time? That is what the question in summation is he's asking. When is going to be an end of days? When is all this going to end? Read it again.
Then answered I and said, what shall be the parting asunder of the times? Or when shall be the end of the first and the beginning of it that followeth?
Go ahead.
And he said unto me, from Abraham unto Isaac, when Jacob and Esau were born of him, Jacob's hand held first the heel of Esau.
Now we read that in Genesis 25, 26, which was prophesied in Genesis 3:15. Read.
For Esau is the end of the world.
So that's what it means. When he took hold of Esau's heel, Esau is the end of the world, meaning the last Gentile ruling power. Go ahead.
And Jacob is the beginning of it that followeth.
Jacob is the beginning of the new world to come. Go ahead.
The hand of man is betwixt the heel and the hand. Other question, Esdras, ask thou not.
So now we understand who the main characters are in the Bible, Jacob and Esau. Jacob's name was changed to what, brothers? Esau's name was changed to what? Edom. Very good. Write that down. Jacob Israel is the hero. Esau Edom is the villain. That's the prelude. That's the prologue. Now, give me Matthew 24. Let's start at verse 3. Matthew 24 and verse 3.
You know, that scripture just brings a smile to my face. It really does, because it lets us know exactly where we are in time. Okay, we're at the end of the Gentile age, like Luke talks about. until their time be fulfilled. That's what we just read here. And this is the this is that eighth head that's going into perdition. We read it right here. This is it. This is good news, brothers.
That's right.
Sisters, this is good news.
Matthew 24, verse 3. Watch this.
Matthew 24, verse 3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?
See, that, so that question is the same question Esdras asked the angel. When shall be the end of the world? The disciples is asking Christ the same question. Now, when you read Matthew 24, Christ never mentions the name Esau. But when you remember, his followers knew scripture. They weren't as heavy as he was, but they knew basic. They knew who Rome was. Exactly. It's our people today didn't know that Rome is ancient Esau. I read on.
Hallelujah. Verse 4. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you.
Take heed that no man deceive. There's going to be a lot of deceit out there in the world. The main culprit behind deceit is, guess who? Esau. They're the main culprits with deceit. Go ahead.
For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many.
Now, the average black Christian goes, Jim Jones. Is Jim Jones many? No, that's not many. That's one. Let's go back a little further than Jim Jones. Let's go back to 1492 when the Spanish Armada came and said, we are Christ, and had the white image of Jesus and forced the so-called Indians to bow and worship that or be murdered. That's, read it again now.
For many shall come in my name saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many.
Are the conquistadors many? You better believe that that's many. That is many. And follow right behind them, you had the French, you had the Germans, the Portuguese, no, behind them was the Portuguese. Then you had the Germans came, so forth and so on, the Russians, Europe, the English, and the United States of America. Yes, the Dutch, too. How could I forget them, them bastards? Read that again.
For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many.
They had that white image of Jesus and deceived many. So we're reading history, right? So Christ starts off letting us know, I'm going to tell you who the devil is. He's that man that's going to portray himself as me.
Exactly. Y'all hear this? He going to throw that shoe and say, no, it's Jim Jones. He going to throw that shoe over there and say, no, it's the little boy with three sixes at his head. It's the Arabs. To get you to not look at him as being what this Bible is talking about. You're the end of the world. You're the devil that the Bible speaks of. He don't want his skirts lifted.
Exactly. Read on.
And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars.
Like, for example, World War III is a rumor of war. It's still a rumor. It hasn't happened yet. It's still a rumor. Armageddon's still a rumor. But guess what? They're going to come. Read.
See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass.
So Christ said, y'all don't be worried about this stuff, for they must come to pass. Go ahead.
But the end is not yet.
He said, but the end ain't yet. Go ahead.
For nation shall rise against nation,
uh-huh,
and kingdom against kingdom.
Go ahead.
And there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places.
So these are various signs of the times. Read.
All these are the beginning of sorrows.
Uh-huh.
Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted.
You Israelites shall be delivered up to be afflicted. Come on.
And shall kill you.
They will kill you, Israelites.
And you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake.
So Christ said, you shall be hated of all nations for my sake. I want to get there. Because although the white man is the devil, he's not the only enemy. When it says all nations, it means just that. It means all nations. The white man has gotten the support and agreement of all nations to support him. Because the white man rules with power, okay? He makes all nations bow and obey him, okay? Read on.
And then shall many...
Like Trump said in the United Nations, the ambassador, what's her name? Oh, Nikki Haley. She said, you voted against us, we're taking names. And all the money we give you, nations, you have the audacity to vote against us, to insult us, we will remember that. That's a threat. Thank you.
hundreds of millions of dollars and even billions of dollars, and then they vote against us. Well, we're watching those votes. Let them vote against us. We'll save a lot. We don't care.
What we witnessed here today in the Security Council is an insult. It won't be forgotten. You are going to see a change in the way we do business. For those that don't have our back, we're taking names.
That is a threat. Letting you know we will destroy your economy. That's what they're saying. If America takes back their foreign aid and other things they give to these nations will crumble. They'll be destroyed.
That's letting you know who's running the whole scene.
Exactly.
You got the other nations sitting in there, and that's supposed to be a world court where the majority votes win. They said, listen, I don't give a damn about the vote. Y'all voted against us, y'all in trouble.
That's right. And she said, regardless of what y'all say, our embassy is going to be put there anyway.
Irregardless of the outcome, we still going to do it.
Exactly. Read on.
Verse 10. And then shall many be offended.
Many of you Israelites, because of the onslaught against us. Now, that verse right there, you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake, it covers a multitude. This Matthew 24, you can go for centuries from one verse to another. So, for example, you read about the sub-Saharan slave trade, right, which occurred around 900-something on up to present, thank you. You read about how the Arab invasion, how they destroyed us in Jerusalem. That's how the Ottomans got up in there. The Palestinians, that was part of the Ottoman Empire, okay? They hated the Israelites. They destroyed us from the time of the Middle Ages, the Dark Ages, as some books call it, okay? The white man got the Ottomans together with certain African nations, and they came against us. Not only them, the Chinese. You read about the blacks being sent as slaves in China. Was the Tang Dynasty? Ming and Tang Dynasty. Y'all can look that up and just Google it. It pops up. We the ones that built the Great Wall of China. That was us. We were the slaves because all nations were against us. So that's what you said. And you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And you just think that means now. No, this happened from way back up until today. Read.
Verse 10. And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another. And shall hate one another.
That verse too. Now then shall many be offended and shall betray one. I'm going to show you what Christians do. They leave those verses just for back then during the time of the apostles. It's beyond that. Remember, they're talking about the end of the world. That's the key. The end of the world. Was the apostles the end of the world? No, that was not the end of the world. So what happened with the Israelites? Examine, for example, when you look, I'm going to start with the 1400s. I'll start there. Over here with the Americas when the 10 tribes were here. Summary, and then shall many be offended and shall betray one another. There's a movie called Geronimo. Anybody ever see that? And you have Indian scouts who betrayed their brothers and sisters to help the white man. Y'all familiar with that history? You read about the Buffalo Soldiers, how they got black, our people to fight against our. Remember, the so-called Indians, even amongst the five civilized nations, because what the white man did, he pit one against the other. With the five civilized nations, they said, make them slaves. If y'all want to have little, keep your land and all that, make the blacks slaves. So the five civilized nations, you had the Choctaw, the Chickasaw, you had Seminoles, the Cherokee, there's one more, Meshogi, I can't remember all five. But anyway, what they did amongst the Seminole, when they came to check, they said, hey, how come y'all made these black people here princes and caciques? You made them leaders here. That's not what we said. That's why the Bible says Reuben is the excellency of my strength, the dignity of my strength. Thank you. Okay, they got mad at them and said, we told y'all, make them slaves. And that's what they do. Okay. But Reuben always rebelled against that thing when you read about the Seminoles. Okay. So that's for example. They pit us one against another. We betrayed one another. So that verse there, verse 10, verse 9 and 10 covers centuries. 11.
And many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many.
Many false preachers shall arise and shall deceive many. Even during the time of slavery, they had many false preachers rise up. And remember, on each plantation, you had preachers. Okay, where the white men, if you were Baptist, if Massa was Baptist, guess what the slaves were? Baptist. Master was Catholic. Guess what the slaves were? Catholic. We were as what he was. And if you look at the movie Birth of a Nation with about Nat Turner, they show you how they use the black slave preachers to manipulate and the minds of the slaves. That's what they did. Okay, and Nat Turner was one of many that figured out what the white man was doing. You had Nat Turner figured out, Gabriel Prosser. You had Denmark Vesey. They figured it out. Read on.
And because iniquity shall abound.
And because iniquity means sin. Because sin shall abound.
The love of many shall wax cold.
Like when we bring that verse up, let's bring that up till today. And because iniquity has abounded, you got same-sex marriages. You got, it's proposed that women be single parents, okay? It says, and because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. We don't have that natural love one for another amongst our peoples anymore. It has to be retaught to us. Read.
But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved.
But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. So we must endure to the end. Okay, with the understanding we have in the word of God, we must endure to the end of time. Read.
And this gospel of the kingdom.
The word gospel is Greek, meaning good news. Go ahead.
Shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then shall the end come.
So now remember, it says precept must be upon precept, right? So now we read Genesis 3:15 in conjunction with Genesis 25:26, in conjunction with 2 Ezra 6, 7 through 9. And you say to yourself, well, he doesn't mention Esau by name. Esau's all up in there. Esau's all up in there. He's the main culprit behind all of this. But you got to know the other scriptures that we just read to figure that out. That's why you cannot just start in the book of Matthew and think you're going to comprehend the understanding. You're not going to get the understanding. You got to start from the beginning, Genesis. Okay, read.
Verse 15. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation
go ahead.
Spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Whoso readeth, let him understand.
Now, when you read the prophet Daniel, he talked about the abomination of desolation twice. He prophesied the Greeks would destroy the temple and set up the abomination and make it desolate. Then he prophesied about Rome doing the same thing. So Christ was talking about Esau, Edom, but he just never mentioned their name. That's why it says, whoso, what does it say?
Whoso readeth, let him understand.
You got to read. Read what? Because the New Testament wasn't written yet. So read what was Christ talking about? The Old Testament. Most of you Christians have never read the Old Testament, except that's why you talk about Noah had the ark with 2x2 animals. Noah didn't bring no 2x2 animals. He brought 7 clean animals and 2 unclean. Learn to read the Bible, please. Got the kids singing 2x2. When the Bible says 7, 7 unclean, 7 clean and 2 unclean. So that's 14 clean animals, male and female, and 4 unclean, male and female. Y'all understand that? That's basic math. Not that I'm a mathematician, but you understand what I'm saying. So, I want to talk about phase one of the heroes. No, give me the video. Give me the video of Pep. I'm going to show you Joseph Campbell. This is his thesis on the hero's journey. Just listen to it.
What do Harry Potter, Katniss Everdeen, and Frodo all have in common with the heroes of ancient myths? What if I told you they are all variants of the same hero? Do you believe that? Joseph Campbell did. He studied myths from all over the world and published a book called The Hero with 1,000 Faces, retelling dozens of stories and explaining how each represents the monomyth or hero's journey. So, what is the hero's journey? Think of it as a cycle. The journey begins and ends in the hero's ordinary world, but the quest passes through an unfamiliar, special world. Along the way, there are some key events. Think about your favorite book or movie. Does it follow this pattern? Status quo, that's where we start. 1 o'clock, call to adventure. the hero receives a mysterious message, an invitation, a challenge. 2 o'clock, assistance. The hero needs some help, probably from someone older, wiser. 3 o'clock, departure. The hero crosses the threshold from his normal, safe home and enters the special world and adventure. We're not in Kansas anymore. 4 o'clock, trials. Being a hero is hard work. Our hero solves a riddle, slays a monster, escapes from a trap. 5 o'clock, approach. It's time to face the biggest ordeal, the hero's worst fear. 6 o'clock, crisis. This is the hero's darkest hour. He faces death and possibly even dies, only to be reborn. 7 o'clock, treasure. As a result, the hero claims some treasure, special recognition, or power. 8 o'clock, result. This can vary between stories. Do the monsters bow down before the hero, or do they chase him as he flees from the special world? 9 o'clock, return. After all that adventure, the hero returns to his ordinary world. 10 o'clock, new life. This quest has changed the hero. He has outgrown his old life. 11 o'clock, resolution. All the tangled plot lines get straightened out. 12 o'clock, status quo, but upgraded to a new level. Nothing is quite the same once you're a hero. Many popular books and movies follow this ancient formula pretty closely.
But what he went through, you can read about the history of Moses. You can read that with Gideon, Samson, all of the prophets in the Bible. This is where this devil, that's what he is, the devil the Bible speaks of. That's where he gets it from. So I want to talk about what he mentioned about phase one. The hero always feels out of place. Like when you look at the movie The Matrix, you know how Neo was like, something ain't right. It's like when we're in this world, I'm talking about us, I'm talking reality now. You look at the way society is and you go, something ain't right. I don't know what it is. I can't put my finger on it, but we shouldn't be oppressed the way we are oppressed. You ever get that feeling?
Everybody in here should understand exactly what the, when you start questioning your reality,
exactly.
You start looking around, you say, wait a minute, just don't seem right. Something exactly. Don't, like you said, something don't smell right. Well, how come we are all on the bottom?
Right.
That kind of thing.
Exactly.
You start scratching your head because reality starts to show you certain things.
Exactly.
Bishop, you know that's a scripture, right?
What?
And what is it, Job 32:7, that one? I don't want it, but that's...
What you want? What does it say?
What about days should speak? And then the one after that, it says, but there is a spirit in man.
Right.
That one. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, read that
about.
Real quick. Read that. That's good. But all of us in here, we felt that way. That's like me and my wife, when we almost got killed, right. We saw something ain't right.
Exactly.
We almost died in Fifth Avenue. We was hanging out one day.
Right.
Long, funny story, but I ain't going to tell you. Anyway, I said, you know what? We got to get right. Something ain't right. So we went to church. Then church was garbage. We went to the Kemetic community. That was garbage. We went to the Nation of Islam. Mm-hmm. We said, something ain't right.
Something
no, stuff is garbage.
Exactly. Something ain't right.
Read that, Isaac.
Job chapter 32, verse 8. But there is a spirit in man.
Start with 7.
Verse 7. I said, days should speak. And multitude of years should teach wisdom.
A multitude of years being on this earth should tell you something. You should learn something by just being on this earth for so many years. Go ahead.
But there is a spirit in man.
That's the part I want. But there is a spirit in man. That spirit in man is what the Most High puts in us for us to question our reality. Read.
And the inspiration of the Almighty giveth them understanding.
And the Bible gives us understanding about what we see and what we experience, and that's why we walked in here.
Exactly. Now watch this. Get Sirach 4:17. This goes in conjunction with that verse that y'all just read. Sirach 4:17, please. Ecclesiasticus. This is what happened to us before we all came up in here.
The book of Sirach, chapter 4, verse 17. For at the first... she will walk with him by crooked ways.
Jump up to 11 and see what it's talking about.
Verse 11. Wisdom exalteth her children and layeth hold of them that seek her.
So the subject is wisdom. Now jump down back to 17.
For at the first, she will walk with him by crooked ways.
That's us in our life. our ordinary life, we are walking around. Wisdom was always with us. Why? Because the proof is that we came in here eventually. Go ahead.
And bring fear and dread upon him.
Uh-huh.
And torment him with her discipline until she may trust his soul and try him by her laws.
Go ahead.
Then will she return the straight way unto him.
That's where we're at now. We're at the straight way. Because for many years, all of us up in here walked by crooked ways. Whether we were adulterers, liars, thieves, punks, or prostitutes, those were crooked ways. Now we come in the truth saying, you know what? We ain't right.
Right.
Something ain't right in this world. I shouldn't be living like this. Exactly. Okay, read that again.
Then will she return the straight way unto him and comfort him and show him her secrets.
I'm going to give her another one. Give me Deuteronomy 28. I love this one, Deuteronomy 28. See, in Deuteronomy 28, the Christian apologists like to say that's their fundamental foundation because you can't disprove Deuteronomy 28. If you can prove slavery never happened, then we give the Bible away.
Bishop, they first have to deal with Esau. But they don't need to be talking about our Bible, period.
You're right about that.
They don't need to be talking about Deuteronomy 28, nothing.
Nothing. They need
just
to shut
deal
the hell
with
up.
Obadiah. I keep telling y'all that. Deal with Obadiah. That's the only thing you need to worry about. That's your book.
So, Deuteronomy 28, verse 33 and 34.
Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 33.
Now, Deuteronomy 28, 33 goes into colonialism. Watch this.
The fruit of thy land and all thy labors shall a nation which thou knowest not eat up.
Uh-huh.
And thou shalt...
Man, they take all your resources. Go ahead.
And thou shalt be only oppressed and crushed always.
And thou shalt be only oppressed and crushed always. Like, for example, we went over last week about the mayor, the new black mayor in Camille, Georgia. They refused to give the brother the keys to his office. Camille, Georgia is 70% black, and they said, we don't want blacks in office. But black people voted him in office. And the whites that got little control, they said, we ain't giving you the keys to your office. Now he's upset. They got a cemetery, a black side and a white side. The white side got a, what's the stone things called? The tombstones got your name, date of birth, date of death. The black side of the cemetery has just concrete slabs. Then you're not allowed to put your name, your date of birth, or date of death. In 2017 in Camille, Georgia, look it up. Read, brothers and sisters. Look, his name is Mayor David Rufus, okay, in Camille, Georgia today. The brothers went down there. Some of the brothers from Atlanta went down there to interview him today. I'm waiting to see how that goes. Now read that again, Captain Isaac.
The fruit of thy land and all thy labors shall a nation which thou knowest not eat up, and thou shalt be only oppressed and crushed always.
And we always ask that question. Why are we always oppressed and crushed always? See, the Christian church don't want to talk about oppression and being crushed always. But we are the servants of God. We're going to talk about it. Because the prophecy says we shall be oppressed and crushed. How long, brothers? Always. Read.
So that thou shalt be mad for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see.
Are y'all mad? Are y'all mad?
Yes, sir.
I'm mad as hell. This is why I came up in this truth. I saw what I saw. I said, this SH ain't right. Something ain't right. I don't know what it is, and I ain't crazy.
Exactly.
But it ain't right. I can't put my finger on it. Now watch this. Ecclesiastes 7 and 7. Yes. So this is that phase one. When you start realizing this ordinary world, what we think is ordinary. Remember, oppression has become so normal to us.
Right.
But there's those of us spiritually, the spirit said, mm-mm, something ain't right with this. This is not normal. Read that.
Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 7.
This is in the regular Bible. Go ahead.
Surely oppression maketh a wise man mad.
Surely oppression maketh a wise man mad. Remember, it said, thou shalt be oppressed and crushed always, so that you shall be mad for the sight that you shall see. Solomon's saying the same thing in Ecclesiastes. Read it again.
Surely oppression maketh a wise man mad.
It doesn't say make an idiot mad. It says a wise man. An idiot goes on a rampage and starts murdering people. Wise men don't do that. Wise men sit back and organize. Wise men sit back and consider the beginning of a situation to the outcome of a situation. Read it again.
Surely oppression maketh a wise man mad.
And that's us, brothers and sisters. We are the wise. That's what we're gathered together. we see that there's a problem in this so-called ordinary world with our oppression being crushed always, and we figured out something ain't right. Okay. Give me Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 1.
Ecclesiastes chapter 4 and verse 1. So I returned and considered all the oppressions that are done under the sun.
So he considered all the oppressions under the sun. Watch this.
And behold, the tears of such as were oppressed.
The tears of such as were oppressed. That's us. That's you and me. The tears of such as were oppressed. Go ahead.
And they had no comforter.
We had no comforter. Remember, so we shall be oppressed and crushed always. Go ahead.
And on the side of their oppressors.
And on the side of the white man.
There was power.
There was power. He has the economic power. He has the military power. He has the political power. On his side is power. We have nothing. Go ahead.
But they had no comforter.
And we have no comforter. So that's why Christ said in John 14, I'll just rush through it, where he said, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall send you another comforter. And no, that comforter is not no damn Elijah Muhammad. Excuse my language. It ain't Elijah Muhammad. No, who they say? Did they say it was Farad Muhammad? Who they said that was?
They said it was Elijah, but he was
just... Yeah, he's not the... No, he's not. No, no, no. Stop. Right. So now, that was phase one, where you realize something ain't right in the ordinary world. Phase two, as they said, was the call. The call, and I would talk about, again, remember what I said. The villain of the story always portrays himself as the righteous. That's what they do. Give me the video. I want pep talk. I want to talk about the call. Now, this is what they do. This is what Esau does. Watch this. And I'm going to show you the video. They look for this cute little fat little kid, little black kid. And he's talking about what it is to be a hero. And then when he names three heroes, I want y'all to see if he names any black people or Latin people who are heroes. But to come, other than that, I pull that out and I said, you know, what the little kid is saying, it's cool. I like the beginning of it. It goes off near the end. But pull what you can and subdue what's not right. Play the video.
This one goes out to the heroes. Everyday heroes. Yeah, I'm talking to you. You probably are all like, I'm not a hero. You're talking to the wrong person. And I'm all like, you're talking to your TV.
So listen up. I think you're a hero and you don't even know it yet.
Maybe you're like me. You look in the mirror and you don't really see a hero.
You look and you just see a regular kid. Really good looking regular kid. But you're a hero. Whether you're a kid or a grown up, you're way more than you might think you are.
You're more than your problems and you're more than your mistakes.
Somewhere inside, you're a hero.
You might not have a cape or wear underwear outside your clothes.
That's probably a good thing. You have everything right now to change the world. Everything. Heroes are just ordinary people who've done extraordinary things.
They inspire other people to be extraordinary.
People like Nathaniel. He's 12 years old, and he's not okay with the fact that there are people in the world who don't have...
He's standoffish. He don't really love the people. You can see it. Stop from the little crack demon right here. Just look at his whole countenance.
Clean water. He raised enough money to help 30 schools in Central Africa.
Madison. When she was 15, she created...
See, another Edomite hero. I'm like, what is this? I'm sitting there watching, waiting for the black heroes. I'm like, what? I got sorely disappointed.
That's that splinter, Bishop, like we was talking about earlier. Certain things like this go over people's head, just like the reality of this society. Many of us are like zombies in this system and don't realize that it is set against us. We actually think this is normal.
Right. This is actually subliminal.
Exactly. That's
the point.
Remember
the kid said, you look in the mirror and won't even see a hero.
Exactly.
Like the scripture says, as a man thinketh, so is he. The white man knows that understanding. Make them think all they are is pimps, drug dealers, and
exactly.
Rappers, and that's all we see ourselves as.
Exactly.
Okay? When the Lord says, no, you're much more than that. Come on.
Because she wants to celebrate real beauty. My friend Bob, he's 55, and he's living out love in so many different ways. Right now, he's working on building the school, so kids in Uganda know they're loved.
Wait, stop! He said he's building something so kids in Uganda know they're loved. Let me tell you the evil behind that. It's like I rob you. I kill your family. Then I come back and say, you need water?
Right.
Here.
You give it.
And now I'm a hero. I'm the villain of the story. I'm the devil. This dude is the devil.
Where's Uganda? The so-called white man don't need to be building nothing over there. There should be a jail built for him, period. He don't need to be building nothing. He need to be put in jail.
Exactly, because he destroyed all of
the people sitting on the ground because of him. Exactly. That's that sleep zombie mind state that don't see the reality for what it really is.
And they put a little black kid with Edomites helping black people. So we go, the white man's the hero. I'm nothing. I need assistance from the white man. He's God. He's the hero of the story. No, that's all subliminal workings.
Right. The man rapes you, then he offers you therapy, and you call him a hero.
Right. Exactly. Come on.
Kids can change the world, and grown-ups can change the world. It would go a whole lot faster if we worked together. Heroes are made when ordinary people like you and me decide to be extraordinary. Or extra. Ordinary.
Extra ordinary. That's too many extras.
Here's what I'm trying to say.
If you want to be awesome, treat people awesome. It's about strength. Fire power.
Not like picking up a car kind of strength.
I'll pick it up and just drop it and go like, oh, he's so nerdy, but so strong. I want to go out with him. He can pick up a car.
But it's not about that. I'm talking about compassion. Nothing stronger than that.
It's what changes things.
So who's been the hero to you?
Da-da-da.
Parents?
Teachers? Friends?
Let them know. Heroes don't always know that you're heroes.
We all need reminders.
The little things that we do are a big deal.
Heroes are people in our lives who see us what we really are.
Awesome.
Did you hear that?
Uh-huh, I said it. You're awesome!
You're awesome!
You don't need a cape and you don't need money. You don't even need to be bitten by something radioactive.
You just need to care. And if you are bitten by something radioactive, you should go to a doctor, sir. It'll make you pee green.
It'd be cool to fly or be part spider or be part squirrel.
I don't think part squirrel is a thing. Is that a thing? Like a man squirrel?
But you're already filled with superpowers.
So don't wait for a signal in the sky. Look a little closer at the world around you.
You're ready right now. It's time to be the hero that you're meant to be, Cape. What are you not okay with?
Think about it.
Now what do you have?
And who can you bring with you?
Everybody. So now everybody's a hero.
Everybody.
It is.
You have everything that you need to make someone's day more awesome.
Someone may never told you this, but
you hear the music?
It's true. The world needs heroes, and that hero could be you.
This is that triumphant, inspirational, mesmerizing music.
Yeah.
And they find a little cute, fat black kid.
Let's do this.
They go, oh, this is so cute. Look at this. But to examine it in its entirety, there's so much evil up in this thing. Okay? The white man's the hero. What was you going to say, Lala?
Yeah, you noticed that, Bishop. He didn't show nobody would look like him.
That's
you understand his mindset right now. He's in a world where the only way he can feel like he made it is towards the master, the white man. If he don't reach it that way, he's not going to make it in his life. And he's telling all the kids the same. Because he's a black kid. He don't sure know he was as black. Then because they're trying to change him and they say everybody's a hero. No, that's not what they made the commercial for. The commercial, they're showing you white people, he's his hero.
Right.
You understand?
An example, black our people always seek to see themselves as a hero in movies. For example, when we went to see Django, black folks love Django because in that movie he's killing all the white folks, all of them. Miss Laura, Mr. Candy, the coon stepping, people love that movie. When they came to see, even before that, you had Blade. Now Wesley Snipes. Now I love Blade. I loved it.
Part one.
Two was good too, but three turned him into the sidekick. Ryan Reynolds. They ruined it because it was blowing away Matrix. Matrix one was good, then two and three came out and it was horrible. So Blade started to take over. So okay, we gotta downplay this because he's doing too well. Make him a sidekick in his own movie, and that pissed him off. It made him old and weak, whatever. He thought Dracula was horrible. That was three. Then you had what else? You had that one. Then you have another one. Black Panther's coming out. Black folks are going to see that. Black folks are going to see it. All men here probably going to see it. Because we see this brother. He's royalty. He's wealthy. He's smart. Not effeminate. He's the hero. And we usually see white folks in that role. So when black folks see a black man, we're like, well, we got to see that movie because we're not used to seeing ourselves depicted in that manner. It's a black director. It's a black writer. It's the black actors all throughout the movie. So we're like, wow. So you see, even in a carnal state of mind, our people seek to see ourselves in a bright light or a heroic light. And we don't have it. Exactly. And the Bible, of course, shows us that we've been heroes for centuries. Exactly. Centuries. And they whitewashed all of the heroes. All of them. Superman, they don't whitewash. You know what Superman supposed to be? He's supposed to be our Messiah and so forth. They whitewash him. And you had, who else? You have all the black heroes are always weak and simple, like freaking Justice League, Cyborg, moping around. He's the most, he's the smartest one of all of them in the group. And the most weak one, oh, I'm a monster. No one likes me. Then here comes Wonder Woman. Oh, you're perfect. Oh, help us. Okay, I'm going to help you because the white woman asked you to help. I'm going to help now. I'm like, oh, this is garbage. But that's an example. So if you have a black man among white heroes, he's downplayed. He's weak. Yeah, Static Shock on cartoons. Static Shock. He had a white sidekick. Oh, give it that. End that right now. No, give it that. It's always been that way. Always. Have a switch real quick. Get Ecclesiastes 8:14, which goes right along with the topic, in terms of how they take how the villain is perceived as the righteous and the hero is perceived as the villain.
Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 14.
The psalmist saw this in the spirit. Yeah.
There is a vanity which is done upon the earth.
Uh-huh.
That there be just men.
There be just men will be the Israelites. There be just men, righteous men keeping the commandments, righteous men and women keeping the commandments. Go ahead.
Unto whom it happeneth according to the work of the wicked.
They'll say that we're brainwashed and we're wicked. Yet they'll celebrate Christmas, New Year's, Halloween, and you ask them why, they don't know. But somehow all of us in this room are brainwashed. When you ask them, why you celebrate that for? I just do it. Why you do it? I don't know. So aren't you brainwashed? So, and it says here, Solomon says, you'll see just men, but they'll be deemed as the wicked, working as the wicked. Go ahead. I mean, we're the villains. They're the heroes, we're the villains. Go ahead.
Again, there be wicked men.
There be wicked men. Edom primarily, the ringleader, the main antagonist, the main villain. Go ahead.
To whom it happeneth according to the work of the righteous.
He's righteous. He's Christ. He's Superman. He's Spider-Man. He's Batman. He's Thor. What are we? Niggas. Wetbacks, spooks, savages.
Sambos
and coons. That's what we are. Exactly. So it's the same thing. Solomon's saying that's a vanity under the sun. We're going to see the righteous being deemed as the wicked and the wicked being deemed as the righteous. Solomon saw it thousands of years before it took place.
I just want to piggyback off exactly what Deacon Ithon just said and what you pointed out in the film with the Uganda situation. I just want to drill it home and then I'm going to be quiet for a minute. In the book, y'all all right? Years ago, I read the book Malcolm X's final speeches, his last speeches. And in one of the chapters, it spoke about a situation where if I take a knife and stab you in your back 6 inches and pull it out 3, that's no progress. If I pull the knife all the way out, that's still no progress. Because the hole that the knife made is still there.
you feel, however, that we're making progress in this country
No. I will never say that progress is being made. If you stick a knife in my back 9 inches and pull it out 6 inches, there's no progress. Mm-hmm. You pull it all the way out, that's not progress. The progress is healing the wound that the blow made. And they haven't even begun to pull a knife out, much less try and heal the wound.
They won't
even admit the knife is there.
The point that about this here, the clip that you just showed, is praising white folks
right, for
being in Uganda when, like I said, they should have been in jail. But the fact that they're put up there, you're just going to forget the fact that they stole a whole continent.
And destroyed
the people. And because they want to build one facility that only 5 of you could fit in, you want to put them on a pedestal.
Right.
These people won't even admit that the knife that they stuck in your back, they won't even admit the knife was there.
Right.
Not only did they stab you 3, pull it out some, pull it all the way out, the blow that the hole made is still there. They won't even say that they stabbed you.
Exactly.
Yeah, you forgot destroy leaders, co-op leaders, that is your people. Mm-hmm. Now they come as a hero. Yeah, they are co-op, the one who's supposed to stand up for us. Then now they stand up like the hero.
Exactly. Exactly, exactly. Get Proverbs 23 and 7. This is a psychological tactic or technique that the white man has studied thoroughly from the time of slavery. When you read the Willie Lynch letters, watch this.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 23 and verse 7. For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he.
As he thinketh in his heart, so is he. As he thinketh in his heart, so is he. From the time of slavery, when they made it illegal for us to read and write, they have always portrayed us as the Sambos and the Coons and the underling, okay? Through the first black hero that we ever saw, the first black hero, if I'm not mistaken, y'all correct me, was Blank Man, starring Damon Wayans. Then you had Meteor Man, starring Robert Townsend, another crappy black hero. I'm like, there's no black heroes to really look at. None. When the Black Panthers started, those were true heroes now. They demonized them. They said, no, they're evil. Black Panthers, SNCC, Nation of Islam. Who else was black there during that time? Give me some names. You had Stokely Carmichael. You had, give me some names. Fred Hampton. Give me some more people. There's other groups. You had AIM, the American Indian Movement. You had the Brown Berets. You had the Young Lords. Thank you. They were all demonized. No, they're evil. They're evil. Oh, they're so evil. And they put it out there so people stay away from them. So as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So if we always have the mindset that we're nothing, we look at videos and TV and it always portrays whites as the heroes of society, the saviors, the deliverers. We always look to them. That's why when we say about talk about the kingdom of heaven, the first thing black destroyed men and women, Latin destroyed men and women say is what? What about the white man? What about Master? He's the savior. We can't have a society where he's not ruling. That's the mindset of the typical black and Latino. And a BHI. Give me Wisdom of Solomon 4:12. This links up with as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. As a man thinketh. What did they do to get our minds to think that we are nothing? Watch this.
Wisdom of Solomon chapter 4 and verse 12. For the bewitching of naughtiness doth obscure things that are honest.
For the bewitching of naughtiness. Naughtiness is another word for sin. To be bewitched means they what? They put a what on us? A spell. They cast a spell. All through their TV shows, their media outputs, they're casting spells. You talk about the Haitians with their voodoo. That don't work. The white man's witchcraft is the greatest witchcraft on earth. That has memorized the entire planet into thinking a certain way. They have hypnotized everybody for the bewitching of naughtiness. Go ahead.
Doth obscure things that are honest.
Doth obscure, meaning makes cloudy things that are honest. Things that are true, meaning, for example, that we are the heroes of God's story. We are God's anointed. That's obscure. No, 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 no. And they put up the Caucasian man.
Bishop, real quick. I'm going to give you an example on what the scripture just said. For the bewitching of naughtiness. What did it say there? Read it again.
For the bewitching of naughtiness doth obscure things that are honest.
This man's witchcraft, just like you said, is tops. Mm-hmm. His witchcraft is so good. I want y'all to listen. His witchcraft is so good, he could tell you that Jesus is white, so-called Caucasian.
With no scripture.
There's no Bible on the planet that says that Christ looked like that. All of the Bibles, when you read them, shows you that he's a black man. But yet, nobody believes what's in the scripture.
Right.
With no scripture at all, they say that Jesus, all in the movie theater crying.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
That's some major witchcraft there.
It's a major bewitching right there. Read that again, Captain Isaac.
For the bewitching of naughtiness doth obscure things that are honest.
God says, it is not good for man to be alone. Let us make a helpmeet like unto him. Created a woman. White man says with his bewitching no. Same sex. You dudes can lay down together. And we go, yeah, that sounds good. That might be all right.
He gets off on that.
So, and they're doing it with our people. We are bewitched. I'm serious.
Something is penal. Or if you stole something and you give it to this young man over here, you are an accessory to the crime. You will be charged just as this young man was. Y'all know that crime, right? Y'all know that law?
But the white man, his forefather, stole and destroyed the whole country, passed it down to his children. But that law don't apply to him. It don't apply. It just don't apply.
And we ain't even looking for the law to apply to him.
We ain't looking for
it. We don't even want the law to apply to him.
Exactly. Exactly. Read that again.
For the bewitching of naughtiness doth obscure things that are honest.
Right. Things that are honest is for a husband and wife, a family unit. Husband involves a husband and wife, a mother and a father. Society says, nope, bewitching. Women, you can do it alone. You don't need that man. If you get rid of him, we'll give you aid. We'll give you Section 8, welfare, housing. And they go, the women go, that sounds good. I'm an independent woman now. So this is an example. These are just a few examples of the bewitching of naughtiness.
Bishop, the bewitching is so good that they put it on our sisters. But if you go in their own communities, you find husband and wife.
Yep.
They don't believe in that stupidity that they teach us. When they have babies, husbands and the mothers and the fathers, grandparents, everybody's in there. Mm-hmm. When we're having a baby, there's a note downstairs, don't let that nigga upstairs.
Right. Exactly. You're right about that. We have a baby, they say, you're having too many babies. You need a C-section, do something. But they implore white folk.
They
white
have
women
fertilization
have
clinics that white folks, they stuff it to the brim, trying to make sure that they can have all the babies they want.
Exactly. But didn't you hear sisters say, oh, I don't know if I could, or brothers, I heard a few of y'all in here wrote us or called me and said, I don't know if I should have, my wife should have a baby. Why? Because we don't have money. I said, well, where does it say that you need money? I don't know about it. I didn't come from money. And my family was huge. With 8 uncles, 7 aunts. I had a big family. And they were dirt broke. And guess what? We had fun. We lived good. We didn't understand nothing about poverty. Growing up, took a bath in a little tin tub. I didn't know that was poor. I had fun. We had a pig farm over there. Me and my brothers would beat the pigs, sneak in there to beat them. I didn't like pigs when I was little. We would sneak and mess, play with the horses. My uncle was screaming to mess with the damn with my cousins. Oh, God, another story. But we had fun.
Exactly.
And we was dirt broke.
Bishop, you know what? One of the main points, I just thought about it, what you said that. Well, because we're old folk. Me and the bishop, you know, we up there in our 50s. We up there. When we were coming up, just like what you said, you would see situations where people are having lots of kids. And they didn't go hungry. You want to know one of the main reasons why that we don't talk about? Because when we were born then, the families were community. They actually was like a village that took right. care to make sure that that mother was not going without this and that.
Right.
They all came together and helped wherever they could. Today with this independent stupidity garbage, that's the reason why you talk foolish. Because just like we was reading earlier, the love of many shall wax, the love of the scripture shall wax cold. We don't know how to deal with each other now. And then we talk that, we pass that stupid thought to each other. Don't have no more kids. Don't do this. Don't do that. It's ridiculous and evil.
Exactly. So read that again, Cap.
For the bewitching of naughtiness doth obscure things that are honest, and the wandering of concupiscence.
The wandering of concupiscence, sexual thoughts, evil sexual thoughts.
Doth undermine the simple mind.
You ever look at movies today? I'm talking about the concupiscence now. You won't find a movie where the white man don't take his clothes off. Every movie. I'm looking at Seinfeld. I'm just sitting there. I'll be cracking looking at stupid Seinfeld, excuse me. George Costanza took his shirt off. And he's fat. He got hair everywhere except around his nipple. I said, this is disgusting. Why do I got to look? I said to the wife, I always say this. Why is that? Is that scene necessary for the show? Or they'll have somebody on another movie sitting on the toilet. That's not necessary for the scene. But they do that to always portray their concupiscence in movie after movie, film after film.
They're pushing the envelope. They're pushing the envelope.
Exactly.
Little more by little until you're all fit.
Remember we was in Belgium? Mm-hmm. It, porno was the normal TV shows. It's not like you got to go to a special channel. I'm sitting there. I'm laying in bed. I hear noises. Can I go to see what the TV on? Mm. I wake up. I'm seeing banging. I'm like, what the hell is this? Brothers think I'm in it doing something. No, bro, that's on TV. I didn't pay for that. Bishop, you know you should not be paying for that. I didn't pay for that. That's normal TV there. What the hell is wrong with you? So,
phase two was, phase one was, you know, you realize the ordinary was something's wrong. Phase two was the hero gets the call. Give me 1 Corinthians 1:26.
1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26.
Uh-huh. Somebody help Captain Isaac over there.
I got it, Bishop. Pages. New Bible. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 26. For you see your calling, brethren.
For you see your calling, brethren.
How that not many wise men.
Not many wise men.
After the flesh.
Like your Cornel West. People like that. That status. They're not called into this. Go ahead.
Not many mighty.
These are your sports athletes. Go
not
ahead.
Many noble.
Not many noble. Those are like your Amos Wilsons and your Carter G. Wilsons. Okay.
Are called.
Are called. So we've been called. Have y'all heard the call, brothers? Have you heard the call?
Yes, sir.
Have you heard the call?
Yes, sir.
So we all got the call. That's why we're here today. We've all received the call of God to come into this truth. Give me Ephesians 4 and 1. Meaning God called you to this truth that you're the Israelite. You're more than you've become. Like, remember, there was a cartoon called The Lion King. Mm-hmm. Remember back in the old school, we saw that thing. And the whole thing is metaphor. If y'all didn't see it, part one, the first one, don't look, the next ones are stupid. Mufasa, I love that dude. Mufasa. Just saying his name makes me scared. Say it again, Mufasa. I love that thing. The son wanders off because he thought the father was there. Simba, simple. Simba represents simple. He wanders off and he starts to live like the pigs and living like the other animals. And the spirit of his father comes back and says, you're more than what you've become. And he tells him, you are my son. You are the king. And it's you got to see the cartoon is fantastic. And it told before he became king, he had to go through what? Trials and tribulations before he became that king.
Look down there. That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
No, please, don't leave me. Father! Don't leave me.
All that comes from the Bible. That's what Joseph Campbell, all that comes from here in the Bible because this is our life, okay? They've made our life into some mythologic thesis, okay? Read on.
Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called.
So we've been called into this vocation. This vocation is our true job. This vocation is that we are preachers. This vocation is that we are prophets. We are seers. We are pastors. We are the 144. Can I hear you say amen?
Amen.
Watch this. Give me 1 Peter 2 and 9. 1 Peter 2:9 about that call.
1 Peter 2:9. But ye are a chosen generation.
See that? The Bible says we are a chosen generation. Now, all this is based upon the writings when you read in Exodus 19, and you got Deuteronomy says something very similar. Go ahead, read again.
But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light.
So God has called us. He called us out of what? Darkness, meaning a life of sin, the life of perversion, into his marvelous light, meaning his laws, his truth. Watch this. Go ahead.
Which in time past were not a people.
Many people read that and don't understand that this is talking history now. What they're prophesying about has become history today. Because at one time, we were called not a people. How so? They said we were what? Three-fifths of a man. They said you're not a man. You are three-fifths of a man. Your vote don't count. You ain't nothing. You're not a people. Read it again.
Which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God.
But we are now, we're realizing, because we've gotten the call. Right. What? We are the people of God? I thought we were three-fifths of a man. I thought we was nobodies and sambos and coons and niggas and specs. God says, no, you are a peculiar nation. You are a peculiar people. You are a holy nation. You are the people of God. Wow.
Mm. Bishop, you know what's heavy? There's a scripture, and I think it's in Peter's, where it says about us being predestinated. That means before we got the call, Bishop, our spirits was out there waiting to be turned on.
Right.
Waiting to be illuminated.
So that bewitching wore off us.
It didn't work on us. It wasn't meant. When they try to use it on us, the very elect, like the scriptures say, it'd mm-hmm. be possible to. You can't deceive them because they were made to be woken up. That call just didn't hit them yet. But when that call hit them, boom. They're like, damn, there's another one. Well, where are they hiding at? None exactly. of your business. They're going to wake up anyway.
Exactly. Yeah, you know, man, how you know that the elect was already predestined for this time, because their prophecy say so. So Esau, all these witchcraft cannot stop the elect from coming waking up, because there was already prophecy before he went his witchcraft to trying to bring us talking about we all one people, and we have to celebrate the New Year's, the Christmas, is Thanksgiving. Then now we said we ain't gonna do that.
Exactly. Oh, read that again, Cap.
Which verse 10? Which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not attained mercy, but now have obtained mercy.
Right, for so long, for centuries, it looked like we have not obtained mercy. From the time the fall of 70 AD, the fall of our homeland, when we fled, from the time of the 1400s and up until the 1600s and 1800s, it looked like we had not obtained mercy from God, because we were no people. We were the slaves of the earth, okay? But now we are the people of God. We are obtaining mercy. From there, phase three, he discussed being sent. Okay, I'm just summing it up. I'm not going through his four or his 12 steps of BS. A lot of it's redundant. Okay, what happened in phase three, as they said, he goes to an older man, a teacher. Let me show you what the Lord does. Give me Malachi chapter 4. This is the prophecy of what happened. When we received, we knew something wasn't right. We received the call, but how did we receive the call? Watch this. Malachi 4, we went 4 through 6.
Malachi chapter 4, verse 4. Remember ye the law of Moses,
my servant,
which I commanded unto him in Horeb for all Israel with the statutes and judgments.
So what you first want to see out of that verse is remember the law of Moses. Read.
Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord.
The prophecy says, I'm going to send y'all Elijah. Don't worry. You might have forgotten your history. The white man was very profound in making sure we've been destroyed mentally and spiritually. Your history's been lost. Like, give me that in Jeremiah. Hold that. We're coming right back here. Jeremiah 17:4. Y'all know this one. Jeremiah 17:4.
Jeremiah 17:4. And thou, even thyself, shall discontinue from thine heritage that I gave thee, and I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in the land which thou knowest not.
So when we serve our enemies in this land, particularly America and other lands, but I'm just talking about America for the second, but all the other, I can't name every place. We have discontinued from our heritage that God gave us. What is our heritage? God's laws. The truth that we're the Israelites, the sons and daughters of God. That's been taken from us. Okay, was there more to that, Captain Isaac?
For ye have kindled a fire in mine anger, which shall burn forever.
Uh-huh. Give me Deuteronomy 32. I want the one that says, you shall be pushed in corners. 26, thank you.
Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 26. I said, I would scatter them into corners.
God scattered us into corners. What are the corners? The four corners of the earth. Go ahead.
I would make the remembrance of them to cease from among men.
So the remembrance that we're the Israelites, the sons and daughters of God, have ceased from among men. We've forgotten who we are. Okay, give me Psalms 83, 4, please. Psalms 83, verse 4.
Psalms 83, verse 4.
Uh-huh.
They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation.
This is what the nation said about us. Come, let us cut them off from being a nation. Go ahead.
That the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance.
That the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance, meaning our remembrance. That's what it's talking about. Go ahead. Because guess what they did? They set themselves up in our land as what? Israel. That's what the villain of the story has done. Read.
For they have consulted together with one consent.
Mm-hmm.
They are confederate against thee.
All the nations came on one consent with this thought. They are confederate against the children of God. Read.
The tabernacles of Edom.
Now he names them. The white man, head demon number one, Edom. Go ahead.
And the Ishmaelites.
The Arabs.
Of Moab.
Chinese.
And the Hagarenes.
Egyptians.
Gabal.
Gibal is African. Go ahead.
And Ammon.
Japanese.
And Amalek.
So-called white men in Israel today.
The Philistines with the inhabitants of Tyre.
That's Africans as well. Those are two other African nations. Go ahead.
Assur.
Assur, the Assyrians.
Also is joined with them. They have holpen the children of Lot. Selah.
So meaning it is true. So Selah means it is true. It's similar to amen. So not just the white man. He's not the only enemy. Because remember what Christ said. You shall be hated of how many nations? All nations. That's what the Son of God said. And that is what has happened. Those prophecies have become our reality today. Go back to Malachi 4, please.
Malachi 4, verse 4.
Mm-hmm.
Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded unto him in Horeb for all Israel, with the statutes and judgments. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord.
So although, remember it says, in 1 Peter says, although we have not obtained mercy, yet we shall receive mercy. The mercy of God is infinite regarding us, okay, regarding his chosen people. Although it looked like we had been forgotten and lost, the Lord promised. He said, I'm going to send y'all Elijah the prophet. And watch what Elijah would do. Read.
And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children.
And he shall turn the hearts of the fathers, which are the hearts of the fathers is the prophets, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to the children, meaning to the children of God, the children of Israel. Why will he have to do that? Because we have forgotten who we are. The nations were in one consent to make sure we would not remember that we are the children of Israel, the children of God. So the Lord promised, he said, I'm going to send y'all Elijah the prophet. Don't worry, I've not forgotten y'all. Read.
And the heart of the children.
And the heart of the children of God, the heart of the children of Israel.
To their fathers.
To our fathers. He said, no, you're more than Martin Luther King. You are more than Malcolm X. You are Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's who you are. That's who you be. That's what Elijah would do. In conjunction with that, Elijah would be the one that would teach us the laws of Moses. And that's what he did. Okay. I'll leave it right there. Go ahead.
Lest I come and smite the earth with a curse.
The Lord said, if I don't send Elijah, I'll have to destroy this earth. But Elijah, this is the evidence that we're in here. He has come and gone. Okay? He has come and gone. Give me. Yeah.
the mere fact that you're in here, meaning this scripture just came to pass. They had to take them a while. Let them chew.
They're gonna let them marinate over the break.
Let that
get
roast.
John 14:26.
John 14:26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost.
But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, right?
Whom the Father will send in my name.
Whom the Father will send in my name.
He shall teach you all things.
He shall teach you all things.
And bring all things to your remembrance.
Now that Comforter, which is the scriptures, Elijah used that power when he came. And he taught us all things. You're the Israelites. We went into slavery for breaking God's commandments. In our repenting, we must return as the Israelites, keeping the law of Moses, which we were commanded in Horeb, like it said in the prophecy. All that. So Christ didn't forget us. The Lord did not forget us. He promised. He said, I'm going to send you another comforter. So the comforter is not Elijah Muhammad. The comforter is the spirit of Christ in his book. And when Elijah came, he said, let me open the book for you. And he showed us precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, line upon line. Can y'all understand that thing? Give me Acts 8:31. What are you going to say?
That's, you know, there's so much you can get out of that. You got to think about the awesome power of the Most High to have this Bible follow us in our captivities. He had to go through these people's hands and act like they was part of it and all that. Mm-hmm. But it was only meant to wake you up only. It had nothing to do with them.
Right. And you know what? A lot of black people say, oh, the white man tampered with the book. He rewrote. No. His pride, his arrogance made him not tamper with it, not change it. Why? Remember, he passed laws so that we couldn't what? So why would he have to change it?
Exactly.
You couldn't read it. He mocked us. He said, look, if they can't read.
Exactly.
So why would he have to change anything? He didn't change nothing. Mm. Read that.
Acts chapter 8, verse 31. And he said, how can
read
I?
Read the verse above it.
Verse 30. And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah and said, understandest thou what thou readest? And he said, how can I, except some man should guide me?
So that's how the Lord deals. The Lord doesn't, you hear these certain BHI on the YouTube talk about, oh, I learned on my own. A spirit came. That's a lie. That's a lie. Don't believe Negroes that say, talk stupid like that. You got women, God speaks to me. All women always talk about God speaks to her. And what she says is never in the Bible. Stop listening to these idiots out there. They're demons. Okay, the Bible says, and you can't learn on your own. Notice, all these YouTube Israel brothers and sisters who learn on YouTube, they're always half-cocked. They always have a short lifespan in this truth. Now, when I say lifespan, I mean endurance in this truth. There's one guy who I used to watch. This guy, I saw him. I said, wow, his videos are very well put together. I think his name was something like Yerushalayim. I was talking with one of the brothers was bringing it out about him. And this dude, he said, I've seen this dude. This dude's bugged out his mind now. He ain't dealing with the Bible. No, he said, the dude is gone. I said, these are these YouTube Israelites who listen to us or other camps and go, okay, yeah, I'm going to put a video together. I'm going to make myself seem like, yeah, I learned on my own, and God is dealing with me. And they come and go like the wind, come and go. No longevity. They are not spiritually guided to do any type of organization at all. Don't put your trust in them. So, Captain, did you finish that?
And he said, how can I except some man should guide me?
How can I learn the Bible except some man should guide me? Give me Isaiah 34:16. I'm going to share something with y'all. I'm going to hip y'all with something. Come on. Somebody help Isaac find Isaiah.
Isaiah chapter 34, verse 16. Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. No one of these shall fail. None shall want her mate.
You can't mate the Bible with no other book. Okay, a brother or sister, somebody said today on today's radio show, it was Sierra Leone, said, how come y'all don't deal with the book of Jasher and Enoch? Because they contradict the Bible. That's why we don't deal with it. The Bible says there's no forgiveness or repentance for Esau. These dumb books say there is. That's why the fathers never included the book of Enoch or the book of Jasher in there. One book talk about mermaids and angels turning into planets. Are you kidding me? That foolishness. Ain't nobody got time for that. We need a sound clip with that woman saying, you know that woman? Ain't nobody got time for that. We need that. We need that thing. Give me Ecclesiastes 12:12.
Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 12. And further, by these, my son, be admonished of making many books, there is no end.
There's many books about God, but there's no end of those types of books. Go ahead.
And much study is a weariness of the flesh.
Much study of those other books is a waste of time. That's what the prophet, the preacher is saying. Was that it?
Yes, sir.
Give me 2 Timothy 2:15. Now, I'm giving you these basic scriptures that we all know, but I'm going to shift it in a second. Just bear with me.
2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. Study to show thyself approved unto God.
Study to show thyself approved unto who?
Unto God.
See, some of y'all come in here. Don't study to show yourself approved unto the bishops, the deacons, or the captains, or the officers. If you do that, you're making a grievous mistake. Study to show yourself approved unto the Most High God. Once you do that, guess what the men and women around you will acknowledge? This brother started making himself approved unto God. You want to prove yourself unto the Lord. When you do that, everybody's going to acknowledge that. But when you do it just for men's sake, you're falling into a very terrible situation there. Read that again.
Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed.
You're going
to
be a workman. Once you study, you will become a workman, not a sitzman. Sit, I said sit, not the other word. Sits, man. Meaning, like in church, Christian church, you study, you read the Bible, but you just sit there. You're in that same church from 5 years old to you're 85. And you never work. Watch this. Okay. Brothers always ask me, what is the formula for study? Sunday, in the old school, I'll use the old school for an example. We were open 7 days a week. Sunday through Friday, we dealt with precept upon precept. One day out of the week, Sabbath morning class, which was like 6 a.m. to, I think, noon, all we did was read from Genesis to Revelation. What I mean by that, we read it like a novel because we had to get a basic understanding of the chronology and the understanding of what the Bible is talking about. I'm going to hit y'all with something very heavy. Just listen to me. Bear with me a second. So Sunday through Friday, precept upon precept. We dealt with precepts. The seventh day, early morning, we started Genesis like around Passover. We started with Genesis. By the end of the year, we finished the whole Bible. So we've read the Bible at least over 10 times already, okay? Well over 10 times, I mean, in completion. So how do you do that? How do you do that? So now to read, you say, well, how many chapters are there? Write this down. The Old Testament has a total of 929 chapters. Write that down. The New Testament has a total of 260 chapters. The Apocrypha has a total of 173 chapters, which totals 1,362 chapters in total. So, that's in the whole KJV 611 Bible. So if we read a minimum of no less than or no more than 4 chapters per day, in 1 year, you will complete the Bible. All you got to do, 4 chapters every day. Start from Genesis. Genesis chapter 1 to Genesis chapter 4 is Sunday. Next day, Genesis chapter, 5 to Genesis chapter, 9. And you go like that. By the end of the year, you've completed the entire Bible. But you got to stay on point with that. Everybody understand what I'm saying? Phase 4. The hero learns the rules and the history of who he truly is and meets his allies, okay? I'm going to give you some brief history, and then I'm going to jump. I'm going to jump. Bear with me. Give me Deuteronomy 28. Just leave it alone. I know what I'm talking about. Deuteronomy 28, read verse 15.
Deuteronomy 28, verse 15.
I'm giving y'all some brief history, then I'm going to jump. Watch.
But it shall come to
I know everybody know they think where I'm going, but you don't know where I'm thinking I'm going. Go ahead.
But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee.
Verse 32.
Verse 32. Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long. and there shall be no might in thine hand.
When it says no might in your hand, as you all know, it means no economic might, no military might, no political might. Write that down. From there, verse 37.
Verse 37. And thou shalt become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword.
It means your national identities would be changed and your surnames would be changed. Go ahead.
Among all nations, whither the Lord shall lead thee.
Jump down to verse 64.
Verse 64. And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people.
How? In slavery. Go ahead.
From the one end of the earth even unto the other. And there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone.
The wood and stone religions is Christianity and Islam. The wood and stone religions is Christianity and Islam. Read.
And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. But the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind.
Meaning, for example, once the emancipation was enforced, they said, oh, the slaves are free. No, the white man set up something called the Black Codes. Okay, under the Black Codes, you had the creation of the Ku Klux Klan, and they terrorized us day and night. Read.
And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee.
And they literally hung us. Go ahead.
And thou shalt fear day and night, and shalt have none assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even. And at even thou shalt say, would God it were morning. For the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see. Verse 68. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again.
The word Egypt means bondage. And the Lord shall bring you into bondage again.
With ships.
Cargo slave ships.
By the way whereof I spake unto thee. Thou shalt see it no more again. And there you shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you.
Now from there, let's jump to Ezekiel 19. Let's go there. Start at verse 1.
Ezekiel
19 is a parable.
Ezekiel chapter 19 and verse 1.
Go ahead.
Moreover, take thou up a lamentation for the princes of Israel. And say, what is thy mother, a lioness?
Now, when it says, what is thy mother, a lioness, remember, this is a parable. Get Galatians 4:26 to explain who our mother is.
Galatians chapter 4, verse 26. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all.
So the parable is talking about Jerusalem. Go back to Ezekiel 19, verse 2 again.
Ezekiel chapter 19 and verse 2. And say, what is thy mother, a lioness? She lay down among lions.
There's no question. It says, what is thy mother? Question. A lioness. Go ahead.
A lioness?
Not a question.
A it's lioness.
Right.
She lay down among lions. She nourished her whelps among young lions.
Go ahead.
And she brought up one of her whelps. It became a young lion. And it learned to catch the prey. It devoured men.
So again, this is a parable. It's going into two kings of Israel, but it's also going into the kingdom of Israel and the kingdom of Judah. So this first one here is the kingdom of Israel. Go ahead.
The nations also heard of him. He was taken in their pit, and they brought him with chains unto the land of Egypt.
Captivity. Go ahead.
Now when she saw that she had waited and her hope was lost, then she took another of her whelps, and made him a young lion.
Right, this is going into the kingdom of Judah. Go ahead.
And he went up and down among the lions. He became a young lion and learned to catch the prey and devoured men.
Because we was wicked, we wasn't right. Go ahead.
And he knew their desolate palaces, and he laid waste their cities. And the land was desolate, and the fullness thereof by the noise of his roaring.
So we were mighty at one time. Read.
Then the nations set against him on every side.
Notice that then the nations, plural, set against him on every side, like we read in Psalms 83, like Christ said in Matthew 24:10. Go ahead.
From the provinces, and spread their net over him. He was taken in their pit.
Y'all ever see that movie, The Chronicles of Narnia, where they put that net, they tied the lion down? They get all that stuff from the Bible. Go ahead.
And they put him inward in chains and brought him to the king of Babylon.
Right, because the king of Babylon was Nebuchadnezzar. Go ahead.
They brought him into holds, that his voice should no more be heard upon the mountains of Israel.
So the two kingdoms of Israel were destroyed because of our sins. From there, give me Revelation 13. Let's start at verse 5. Now, I've gone over Revelation before, Revelation 13, but I'm just going to, I want some key points out of this.
Revelation chapter 13 and verse 5. And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies.
Now, I want y'all to remember what it's saying here. And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. This is talking about the white man. Go ahead.
And power was given unto him to continue 42 months.
That's 3.5 years, which is literally about 350 years. Go ahead.
And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name.
To blaspheme the name of God. Go ahead.
And his tabernacle.
And his tabernacle, which is the Israelites.
And them that dwell in heaven.
And them that dwell in heaven, meaning the angels. So what they did when they blasphemed, they said God is white. The tabernacle of God is white. The angels of God are white. That's what they did. But when you read the scriptures, it gives you the clear description of God, the angels, and the Israelites. Describes them. Go ahead.
And it was given unto him to make war with the saints.
Now, who are the saints? Hold on. Give me the precept for that. Psalm 148, 14.
Psalms 148, verse 14. He also exalteth the horn of his people, the praise of all his saints, even of the children of Israel.
So the word even means indeed. Indeed of the children of Israel. Go back to Revelation 13.
Revelation 13.
What verse were we in?
Verse 7. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints.
And it was given unto the white man to make war with the Israelites. Go ahead.
And to overcome them.
And the white man overcame us through war, an invasion. Go ahead.
And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations.
And not only did the white man conquer the saints, the Israelites, he conquered everybody. Go ahead.
And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him.
See that part right there? Everybody, as a result, shall worship him. Worship, who's the him? The white man. The white man. The so-called white man, Esau, the villain of the story. Read.
Whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world.
Go ahead.
If any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints.
And in case somebody says you're taking it out of context, jump back to verse 7 so we'll keep it in context of what he's making reference to.
And it was given unto him to make war with the saints.
The white man made war against us, the Israelites. Go ahead.
And to overcome them.
He put us in captivity. He defeated us. He conquered us. Go ahead.
And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations.
Jump back down to verse 10.
He that leadeth into captivity
is talking about the white man who overcame the saints. Go ahead.
Shall go into captivity.
That's his judgment. Read.
He that killeth with the sword.
The white man killed us with their weapons. Go ahead.
Must be killed with the sword.
Read.
Here is the patience and the faith of the saints.
Now give me Daniel 7.
That's a good superhero story right there.
You got it right. You right about that. The hero has fallen. Right. Now, what's about to happen? Daniel 7. I think I want to jump down. I want to start at verse 15, I believe.
Daniel chapter 7, verse 15. I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit, in the midst of my body, and the visions of my head troubled me. I came near unto one of them that stood by and asked him the truth of all this. So he told me and made me know the interpretation of the things. These great beasts, which are four kings, which shall arise out of the earth.
Write this down. The four kings that he's making reference to. Babylon. Persia Media. That was one kingdom. Persia Media. The third kingdom was the kingdom of the Greeks. The fourth kingdom was Rome.
Verse 18. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever.
Now, that's where we wanted to get to right there. The saints of the Most High, which are who, brothers? The Israel. We shall, did it say we're going to vote for the kingdom? It says we shall take. Take is a verb. It's an action word. We shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom for how long? Forever, even forever and ever, ever, forever. Read on.
Then I would know the truth of the fourth beast.
Then I would know the truth of Rome. Go ahead.
Which was diverse.
Which was different than the other kingdoms. Go ahead.
From all the others, exceeding dreadful, whose teeth were of iron and his nails of brass, which devoured, break in pieces, and stamped the residue with his feet.
Uh-huh.
And of the 10 horns that were in his head, and of the other which came up.
Stop right there. Now this right here, this fourth beast, which has been a mystery. When you look, hey, pull up Daniel 7, four beasts. Let me show you something. Let me show you the, remember we talked about the bewitching of naughtiness. This great bewitching. Just type in Daniel 7, four beasts. Okay. When you read Daniel 7, start at verse 1. Daniel said, Isaac, now I'm going to show you something about this picture. Now these pictures are worldwide. Read.
Daniel chapter 7 and verse 1.
I ain't going to do too much breakdown in this, but just read.
In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon.
That's the grandson of Nebuchadnezzar.
Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters.
Watch this.
Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heaven strove upon the great sea. And four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings.
The first was like a lion, which had eagle's wings, which represented the Babylonian Empire. Write this down. Some books call it the Assyrian Babylonian Empire. Okay, read.
I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked.
Go ahead.
And it was lifted up from the earth.
Meaning they stopped conquering everybody. Good, because they conquered everybody. Read.
And made stand upon the feet as a man.
Read.
And a man's heart was given to it.
Meaning great wisdom was given to ancient Babylon. Go ahead.
And behold, another beast, a second, like to a bear.
So the second one is a bear. Write this down. Persian Mede Empire. The first, this dual empire, joint, there was a joint rulership. The Medes came in first, followed by Persia. Persia became the greater of the two. That's why some books call it the Persian Medo Empire. Read again.
And behold, another beast, a second, like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side, and it had three ribs in the mouth of it.
The three ribs, well, write this down, Ethiopia, Sabia, and Egypt. Those are the three ribs. Right, they show you right there. Go ahead. Did he say lifted up itself on one side yet? You read that?
Not yet. And okay. It had three ribs. And behold, another beast, a second like to a bear. And it raised up itself on one side.
When it says raised up itself on one side, Persia raised up itself and became greater than the Medes. Go ahead.
And it had three ribs in the mouth of it.
The three ribs, as we said, Sabians, Egypt, and Ethiopia. Go ahead.
Between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, arise, devour much flesh.
That's the three ribs. Go ahead.
After this I beheld, and lo, another, like a leopard.
Now we get into the third empire. This leopard represents the Greek empire. Go ahead.
Which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl.
Four major armies. Go ahead.
The beast had also four heads.
Four major generals. Write this down. You had Ptolemy, Lysimachus, Cassander, and Seleucus.
And dominion was given to it. After this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast.
Now, this is what I wanted to get to. Watch this. Go ahead. What verse is this?
Verse 7.
Watch this.
After this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly. And it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it.
They stamped us with the feet of it, the residue. Go ahead.
And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it. And it had 10 horns.
Now, you see it had 10 horns. Now, Isaac, we started originally
in Daniel 7, we were reading verse 19, right, where he goes back to this fourth kingdom. Second Ezra 12, I think it's 10 through 12.
Second Ezra chapter 12, verse 10. And he said unto me, this is the interpretation of the vision. The eagle whom thou sawest come up from the sea is the kingdom which was seen in the vision of thy brother Daniel. But it was not expounded unto him. Therefore, now I declare it unto thee.
So what's the symbol that Daniel's talking about, brothers? The eagle. What's the symbol of America, brothers? The eagle. So, and what you mean the white man never read this? Hey, oh, they've read it.
So, Bishop, where you get that from? That's the shoe he threw out there.
This is how the villain of the story tries to bewitch everyone. It's, oh, we don't, nobody really knows who the villain is. What, Mr. White Man, you're the villain of the story. Okay, yes, love.
Bishop, we have to change that, put the eagle there.
We got one with an eagle. But when you look at all the Christian commentaries, they got a Tyrannosaurus Rex with 10 horns. And the 10 horns, write this down, represents the EU, the European Union. Well, where we at?
We're at verse 20, Daniel 7, verse 20.
Go ahead.
And the devil's supposed to be, and the dragon's supposed to be red on top of that. They ain't even put that in there. Because that represent them. But that's not even, this part of the scriptures ain't even talking about that. You just read it. It's the eagle. Go ahead.
And of the 10 horns that were in his head.
The 10 horns represents the European Union, the EU. Go ahead.
And of the other which came up and before him. And before whom three fell.
What came up out of these 10 horns? The United States of America. And the three that fell, it was the Spanish-American War. Write this down. Spanish-American War, French-American War, and the War of Independence against Britain. Those are the three that he plucked up. Go ahead.
Even of that horn that had eyes and a mouth that spake very great things, whose look was more stout than his fellows.
When it says whose look was more stout than his fellows, although America's the youngest nation, they became greater than all the other nations prior to it. That's what it means, whose look was more stout than his fellows. That's why all the great inventions came out of the United States of America. Read.
I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints.
And the same horn made war with the saints, the Israelites, us. Go ahead.
And prevailed against them.
And it prevailed against us. Go ahead.
Until,
I want you to look at that, but until, go ahead.
The Ancient of Days came.
Until the Ancient of Days came, go ahead.
And judgment was given to the saints of the Most High.
When it says, and judgment was given to the saints, y'all know what that means? Power. Mm-hmm. Power was given to the saints of the Most High. That's what we waiting on.
Right, that's perdition. That's the perdition that eighth head fell in. That's the same scripture right there.
Exactly. Watch this. I'm going to show you that judgment is power. Revelation 2. We coming back here. Revelation 2. And judgment was given to the saints in the Most High.
Revelation chapter 2 and verse 26. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end.
See that? The end. Remember we started at the beginning of the lesson. When shall the end be? So we got to keep his works, his laws until the end. That's what it means by his works, his laws. Go ahead.
To him will I give power over the nations.
That's the judgment that's going to be given to the saints of the Most High. Power. Right. Go ahead.
And he shall rule them with a rod of iron.
We're going to rule the nations with a rod of iron, meaning we ain't going to play with them. We ain't going to play with Miss Becky. We ain't play with no nation. Go ahead.
As the vessels of a potter. Shall they be broken to shivers?
We're going
to
break the nation's power. We're going to break their will. We're going to break them and make them submit to the laws of God. Go ahead.
Even as I received of my Father.
The same glory Christ was given. Christ, I'm giving y'all that same power. That's why in Matthew, another scripture he says in the Gospels, the works that I do, he said, you Israelites shall do greater. And that's what he's talking about right there. Go ahead. Was that it?
That's it.
Go back to Daniel. And verse 22.
Verse 22. Until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High. And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom.
And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. Remember, the disciples always asked that question. Hold on. Give me Acts 1 and 6. They always asked this question.
The book, the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1 and verse 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?
Will the kingdom be given to the Israelites at this time? And when you read on, Christ said, it's not for you to know the day or the hour. Only the Father knows. Go back to Daniel. Verse 22.
Until the Ancient of Days came and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High.
Power was given to the Israelites. Read.
And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom.
The kingdom of heaven will be established. That's what it's going into. Read.
Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon earth.
Rome, America is an extension of Rome. This is still the fourth kingdom. Go ahead.
Which shall be diverse from all kingdoms and shall devour the whole earth.
Shall rule the whole earth. Go ahead.
And shall tread it down and break it in pieces.
And when it says break it in pieces, the European powers under America, they're the ones that put the imaginary border lines. What nation ends here, which nation begins there. It's the Esau that does that. America does that. Go ahead.
And the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings.
The European Union, the EU, also called what? NATO. Go ahead.
That shall arise, and another shall rise after them. And he shall be diverse from the first, and he shall subdue three kings.
That's going back to America, conquering the Spanish, the French, and the British. He's repeating it. Go ahead.
And he shall speak great words against the Most High.
This man speaks great words against the Most High. Read.
And shall wear out the saints.
How does he speak against the Most High? His what? His science. His science is how he opposes God. In his school system, he teaches what? The Big Bang Theory. That's how he opposes God. Go ahead.
And he shall speak great words against the Most High and shall wear out the saints of the Most High.
How did he wear us out? In slavery. That's how he wore us out. In slavery. Go ahead.
And think to change times and laws.
We're living that right now. When is New Year's Eve supposedly? Is that tonight or tomorrow? Tomorrow. Think to change times and laws. The Bible says the new year begins in what season? Spring. The white man says, oh no, I am God. The white man has a God complex, in case y'all didn't know. Hey, go to that video, The Last Poets. I think Jonah posted it on GroupMe. Look on GroupMe, the regular one, New York GroupMe.
Sun up down on the corner, uptown. I turn around and hear the sound of voices talking about who's gonna die next. Cause the white man's got a God complex. Silent niggas scream for help. Ah, help me, help me. Nigga, make your own help. Shit, you need it. I turn around and hear the sound of jukeboxes playing in bars. Pimps parked outside in big pretty Cadillac cars. Cleaning in a broke dick dog. Sitting in a big fine hog. Dressed very fine in a mohair silk vine. But Jim Dale died next, cause the white man's got a God complex. Hey, brother, what's your sports, my man? I got
okay,
just the thing for you.
Only if y'all get a chance, listen to the whole song. It's a good, it's one of the original rap songs. Original. Okay, way back before a lot of y'all was born. Right, real rap. So we go back to Daniel 7:25, Captain Isaac.
Daniel 7:25. And he shall speak great words against the Most High. And shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand.
The Israelites shall be given into this man's hand.
Until a time and times and the dividing of time.
So notice time is plural, singular, then times is plural, and the dividing of time. So that's approximately 3.5. When you read in Revelation, it talks about 3.5 years, saying the same thing. Right, that's that 42 months, exactly. Read on.
But the judgment shall sit, and they shall take away his dominion to consume and to destroy it unto the end.
This man's going to be destroyed. Go ahead.
And the kingdom and dominion.
What? Listen good to this part. And the kingdom and dominion.
And the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven.
What's under the whole heaven? The planet Earth. Go ahead.
Shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High.
So this kingdom's not going to be given to all races. This kingdom shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, meaning the Israelites. Go ahead.
Whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions,
all nations,
shall serve and obey him.
Everybody going to submit to Christ. Why? Because the Israelites are going to make sure all nations submit to Christ. Go ahead.
Hitherto is the end of the matter.
You know what that means? That's what the whole Bible's about. The end. Israel going into slavery, then getting power and ruling all nations on a planet Earth. Yeah, Esau, what did I say? Oh, no, we did go into slavery. Then we get power. I know what I'm saying. Be quiet. We went into slavery. Then we're going to get power. Then we're going to conquer all nations, particularly the so-called white man. He going down. And the first line of defense is going to be Christ when he comes with the angels and smite their power. Then he's going to cut us loose and say, destroy them.
Bishop, I just wanted the enemies to hear that. That's why, yeah. I did that. Wanted them to say it again.
So, verse 28 again.
Hitherto is the end of the matter.
That's what the whole Bible is about. So if you want to know what the whole Bible is about, Daniel 7 gives you the whole plan of God. Hitherto is the end of the matter. So we ain't got to be searching all kind of, what's going to be the end of everything? It's telling you right here. Read.
As for me, Daniel, my cogitations much troubled me, and my countenance changed in me.
The word cogitation means thoughts. Go ahead.
But I kept the matter in my heart.
But I kept the matter at heart. So, during this phase four, we've learned our history, what happened to us, and what's going to be the final outcome for us. That's what we've learned. Now, while you're learning this, you're going to make allies in this truth. You're going to learn that there are other brothers and sisters who are like-minded. Like it says in Romans 11. Let's get that. I had a bunch of scriptures, but because we have short time here, I'm just only going to hit a few. Romans 11, 1 through 5.
Romans 11, verse 1. I say then, hath God cast away his people? God forbid, for I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God hath not cast away his people, which he foreknew. What ye not what the scripture saith of Elias, how he maketh intercession to God against Israel, saying, Lord, they have killed thy prophets and dig down thine altars, and I am left alone.
So Elijah thought he was left alone. Go ahead.
And they seek my life. But what saith the answer of God unto him? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men. Who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal.
You know why that's important? Just like Elijah, so are we. When we realize something wasn't right in this world, when we realize that why are we always oppressed and crushed always, why are we on the bottom, we think we're the only ones that think like that. Say, something ain't right. But then when we hear the truth and come in, we say, oh, we're not the only ones that thought like this. Most times you said, I got 7,000, meaning that's just a certain number of men and women who have not bowed to the knee to Satan. That's what he's saying. What verse was that, Captain Isaac?
That was verse 4.
Read.
Even so then, at this present time, also there is a remnant according to the election of grace.
You see that? Even at this present time. But that's what I want you brothers and sisters to see. Thank you. Even at this present time. Read that again.
Even so then, at this present time, also there is a remnant according to the election of grace.
So there's an election. Okay, that's what y'all seeing here, men and women, part of that thing, part of that election. Watch this. Give me Job 33:23.
Job chapter 33, verse 23. If there be a messenger with him, an interpreter, one among a thousand.
If there be a messenger with him, an interpreter. Interpreter of what? God's word. One what?
One among a thousand.
That's what you brothers are, one among a thousand. Like they had that thing in Django, one among, what does it say? He said one among, I don't say, I think he said 1,000. He said 10,000, but that's all from here. One among, we are that nigga that's one among a thousand. That is us. So that's what the Bible's saying. Read that again.
If there be a messenger with him, an interpreter, one among a thousand, to show unto man his uprightness.
To show unto the Israelites their uprightness. You're more than you have become in society. We're showing our people their uprightness. Give me Sirach 11 and 12. Sirach, Ecclesiasticus chapter 11, verse 12. Yeah. Now watch this. Now this is us. Watch this.
Sirach chapter 11 and verse 12.
Watch. Listen real good to what he's saying.
Again, there is another that is slow.
Mentally slow. That's us. Go ahead.
And hath need of help.
And that's us. We have need of help. Go ahead.
Wanting ability.
We lack ability.
And full of poverty.
We are impoverished. Go ahead.
Yet the eye of the Lord looked upon him for good.
Yet the eye of God looked upon us for good. Read.
And set him up from his low estate.
The Lord's going to set us up from our low estate. Go ahead.
And lifted up his head from misery.
And the Lord shall lift up our head from misery.
So that many that saw it marveled at him.
So that all the nations that see it shall marvel. Watch the same thing in 1 Samuel 2 and 8.
1 Samuel chapter 2 and verse 8. He raiseth up the poor out of the dust.
The dust is his low state of confusion. The Lord's going to raise us up from it. Read.
And lifted up the beggar from the dunghill.
We're the beggar. Always begging for rights. Always begging for citizenship. Begging for welfare. Begging for Section 8. Begging. He said what?
And lifteth up the beggar from the dunghill.
We live in squalor. We live in S-H-I-T. That's how we live. You might think we live in good. I don't care how nice your house is. That's not real living. Read.
To set them among princes.
To set us among princes.
And to make them inherit the throne of glory.
God's going to make us inherit the throne of glory. That's what we just read in the book of Daniel chapter 7. From there, Revelation 7 and 4.
The book of Revelation chapter 7. And verse 4. And I heard the number of them which were sealed.
This are those that were called. And I heard the number of them which were sealed. Go ahead.
And there were sealed 144,000.
This is only talking about the leading men of the nation of Israel. That's what the 144,000 is talking about. Go ahead.
Of all the tribes of the children of Israel.
You see that? From there, give me Ephesians 6. Let's talk about reward. You learn this marvelous truth, but what are you willing to do? The hero in the story always gets a weapon. Right. He gets a majolt. What's his majorna? What's Thor's little weapon thing called? Whatever. Y'all know the MJNs. Thor's hammer, whatever. So you get something. Watch what the Bible says. Give me that in Ephesians 6 and 13 and read down.
Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 13.
Because remember, the Israelites are the hero of this true story. Okay. The white man is the villain, and his cohorts are the other nations. Come on.
Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God.
Now the Lord is saying, now this is spiritual. He's saying through Paul, take unto you the whole armor of God, meaning learn the entire Bible from beginning to end. Read.
That ye may be able to withstand in the evil day.
That you can stand in the evil day, meaning your day of trials and tribulations, so that you can stand. Go ahead.
And having done all to stand.
And having done all to still stand. Read.
Stand, therefore, having your loins girt about with truth.
Have your loins girt about with truth, meaning your mind girt with the truth of God, meaning his laws. Go ahead.
And having on the breastplate of righteousness.
Having on the breastplate of righteousness. The loins of truth and righteousness is all talking about the laws of God. Paul is just being creative in his writing. Go ahead.
And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace.
And the gospel of peace, why? Your feet, because you're traveling. You're going to the diaspora, the scattered of our people, telling them God's good news. You're more than you are in society. You are the sons and daughters of God Almighty. We are the Israelites. That's the gospel of peace that we're preaching. Go ahead.
Above all. Taking the shield of faith.
And above all things, take the shield of faith, Paul says. Why? Because in the scripture, there may be some things you can't answer. You might not know the answer. He says, as long as you got the shield of faith, you're going to be all right. Some people, they can't answer a question. Their faith is destroyed. They had no faith. Oh, I don't know. I'm going to be a Muslim now. You stupid as hell. Just say, bruh, I don't know the answer yet. That's all you got to do. Read.
Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked.
All the fiery darts, meaning the fiery arrows of the wicked. Good? I mean, from the white man. And them arrows is coming from everywhere. Mother, father, sister, brother, the TV, your school teachers, your job. Good?
And take the helmet of salvation.
And take the helmet of salvation. Come on.
And the sword of the Spirit.
And the, see, I love that part. And the sword of the Spirit. Because this fight we're fighting is a spiritual fight. It's not a physical fight with knives and guns. It's a spiritual fight. Go ahead.
Which is the word of God.
And this sword of the Spirit is the word of God. Was that it?
Yes, sir.
From there, give me Hebrews 4:12. We're almost done. Now, remember, in all these stories that when you read in these movies and all that, the hero doesn't emerge until he gets his lightsaber and his weapon. So, or Superman didn't emerge. He got his cape. He got his garment. And you know why all this pertinent? We're watching a video, and these dudes was calling us the Power Rangers. They look like Power Rangers. I'm going to tell you what they're really saying, what Esau says when he's saying that. They're the heroes. Yep. These guys are nothing but heroes. I don't take insult when he calls us Power Rangers.
No.
I say, oh, they see something in us. They see that we're the heroes. That's what they're really saying. That's what they're saying.
We're the subject of their dinner table.
Exactly. And they're trying to figure out how to stop the damn Power Rangers.
They ain't going to stop nothing.
That's what the whole video of. I don't know if y'all see these dudes. That's what the whole video is of. How to stop them. Right.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Stop the saviors. That's it.
Was that it, Isaac?
Hebrews 4, verse 12. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword.
That's your weapons, brothers and sisters. This Bible is the word of God. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. Go ahead.
Piercing even to the dividing asunder.
When you speak the words of God, it pierces asunder what?
Of soul and spirit.
It cuts soul and spirit. See, because you don't see it with your physical eyes, the Lord says, don't worry. I see it. The angels see it. It shall do what it shall accomplish.
Right. We see it. Whenever we read Obadiah,
They're
getting cut. They're getting cut. They can't stand it. They can't stand it.
Go ahead.
And of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart.
See, when the Bible come out, it discerns what you really think. Okay? Just read the scripture. You ain't got to do a lot of interrogation. Read the scripture in the person. You see that flicker, that twitch in the face when you read the scripture. You go over something like, man shouldn't be with, lie down with mankind. You see the homo pop up. What? What was that? They ain't no guilt of the shoe would pop all upside their head. Okay? When you read them laws, whatever the person is, whatever we're guilty of, it's going to hit. We might fake the funk. We put on that poker face. I'm not going to flinch. But when we get home, we can't sleep at night. We tossing and turning because the word of God cut deep.
Hey, you read a scripture, they say, why are you mad? You didn't ever read a scripture.
Exactly. They get mad over reading scripture. People want to fight you over reading scriptures.
You read a scripture. They said, that's your interpretation. You ain't even broke the scripture down yet.
Exactly.
That meant the spirit cut them in their mind.
Exactly.
They just heard it. That's your interpretation. But I didn't even explain it yet.
Exactly. So give me Obadiah verse 21. Obadiah verse 21. So they call us Power Rangers. They're calling us heroes. Watch what the Bible calls us. The Bible calls the elect a lot of things. We're called the elect. We're called 144,000. We're called one of 1,000. We're called the pastors in Jeremiah 3:15. Mm-hmm. Watch what it calls us here.
Hey, when your enemies say things like that, that's a compliment.
Right.
That's how you got to look at it.
Verse 21, book of Obadiah. And saviors shall come up on Mount Zion to judge the mount of Esau.
You see that? Go ahead.
And the kingdom shall be the Lord's.
Letting you know Esau's the last ruling kingdom. After Esau, the kingdom shall be whose, brothers? The Lord's. The Lord. Read it again. I think some of them missed it.
And saviors shall come up on Mount Zion to judge the mount of Esau. And the kingdom shall be the Lord's.
So after Esau, who's the kingdom, brothers? The Lord's. That lets you know that this is the last ruling empire. So when you hear some of these BHI Israelites say, no, the white man is Japheth. Based on that verse alone, read it once again.
And saviors shall come up on Mount Zion to judge the mount of Esau. and the kingdom shall be the Lord's.
After Esau goes down, the kingdom shall be the Lord's. That's what 2 Ezra 6, verse 7 through 9 was saying.
About, exactly.
It's the same thing.
That's Revelation.
Stop listening to these BHI, these black, they're black in their mind, brothers and sisters.
That, again, that doctrine goes right back to not seeing a world without the white man. Right. That's why they're going to make him something else. They he that call it he the musical chairs. They'll make him anything else but who he is, who's Esau, condemned.
Right.
Esau. That's the whole purpose.
Exactly. Where are we going now?
Nehemiah 9:27.
Get that. Watch this.
The book of Nehemiah, chapter 9, verse 27. Therefore, thou deliverest them into the hand of their enemies, who vex them. And in the time of their trouble, when they cried unto thee, thou heardest them from heaven. And according to thy manifold mercies, thou gavest them saviors who saved them out of the hand of their enemies.
So you brothers know who you are? Saviors. Saviors. Christ is the main savior. Don't misunderstand. But the ones, the men that God is raising up under Christ, they're called saviors as well. That's what we read in Obadiah 21. We just read here in Nehemiah 9:27. You brothers understand that? So we've become more. We are more than what we have become here in society. And we have to start seeing ourselves like that, okay? Now, we're almost done. Give me Romans 10:14-15. Right, like Deacon Yossop just said, we're joint heirs with Christ. Christ said, the power I got, you shall do also. You shall have also. Wow.
Romans 10:14. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed?
How can our people call on him in whom they have not believed? Go ahead.
And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard?
They've never heard of a black Messiah named Jesus the Christ. Why? Because of bewitching. The bewitching of naughtiness. Go ahead.
And how shall they hear without a preacher?
And how shall they hear except without a preacher, a prophet? You brothers are the preacher. You brothers are the prophet. You're the ones that's being sent. You've been called. You've heard your calling. Now you're being sent. Come on. What did you say, Lambert? You have something?
You know, the white man said that our people said the white man did not tell us that Christ was black. So what the hell y'all get that from?
Exactly. Exactly.
Verse 15. And how shall they preach except they be sent?
And how could you prophesy? That's what preach means, prophesy, except you be sent. Go ahead. Was that it?
As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel
of
peace.
How beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace.
And bring glad tidings of good things.
Brothers, that's when we go around teaching, we're bringing glad tidings of good things to our people. Why? Because we have been destitute, down and out from this truth. Now today is a new day. Okay, give me 1 Corinthians 1:21. And understand, the Lord, he could come overnight and do his own thing and change everything. But his plan is this.
1 Corinthians.
You brothers want to know how you fit? Here we go.
1:21. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe.
How is God going to save us that believe? By what, brothers? Preaching, the foolishness of preaching. What? Ain't he going to come from the sky? But before that happens, brothers, he says they must be saved by your preaching. That's the first thing that must happen.
You know what's so awesome about that? That's how the Lord gets down. He likes to take what you consider, what this world has considered insignificant, and he's going to use the foolishness of preaching to set this whole place on fire.
Because
the angels got to back up the word of the Most High.
That's
when that
right
word
there.
Come out, they get activated, and those angels got to move.
There you go. There you go.
That's the equivalent of Moses with a stick.
Exactly.
Basically.
With a stick.
With a stick. I call it a stick. The staff. With a stick, he brought down the whole Egyptian empire with the power of the Most High.
Exactly. Now, what else he's saying? Just preach my word.
Just preach my word.
Just prophesy.
I got the rest.
I got the rest.
That's beautiful.
Zechariah 4:6. I thought you got something after this?
Zechariah 4:6. Then he answered and spake unto me,
saying. Listen good.
This is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might.
Not by your might.
Nor by power.
Nor by your power.
But by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts.
You see that? But by the spirit of the Lord. That's how this is going to happen. This is how this is going to get down. Zechariah 4:6. You got something, Ithan? Come on.
This is piggybacking off what Deacon Yasa mentioned about Moses and the stick. Wisdom of Solomon 11, verse 13 to 14.
Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 11, verse 13. For when they heard by their own punishments the other to be benefited.
Right, this is the punishments here is Egypt, and the benefit was us and we got delivered out of Egypt. Go ahead.
They had some feeling of the Lord.
Right, the Egyptians did. Go ahead.
For whom they rejected with scorn when he was long before thrown out at the casting forth of the infants.
That's the killing of the boys. Go ahead.
Him in the end.
Him, the same who was cast out forth from the infants, who was not killed, but the rest of the infants. Go ahead.
When they saw what came to pass.
When we saw what came to pass. Go ahead.
They admired.
What did they do?
Admired.
Moses became the admiration of the people. He became the hero. Remember, they said, who you made a judge over us? Remember, he ran off. He killed the Egyptian for that brother. They said, who made you a judge and ruler over us? And he fled for 40 years. Then when he came back and delivered them, it said him they admired in the end. He became the hero of Israel in the end. But with just a stick. Like the Yahs, just that stick.
Right. But when you look at heroes and villains, right? In this society, it's hard to tell, without the scriptures, it's hard to tell who the villain is. You know,
that's why it says Mystery Babylon.
Right. You know, that's why we going to be on the street and we going to be teaching the Bible. We're going to say, listen, the white man going into slavery. The white man is wicked for all the evil that he have done. Edom is wicked. All right. And people are going to watch at us as the villains, you know. But all this evil this man did throughout all these centuries, they ain't watching at him as the villain. What he did to the North American Indians, they ain't watching at him as the villain. But I want to read a scripture for you all.
Real quick, Mike, before I forget. Real fast. Verse 14 one more time. I missed something.
For whom they rejected with scorn.
It goes back to what Deacon Malachi just said. Moses was rejected with scorn. Right. Who made you a judge and ruler over us? They mocked him. Who the hell are you to be a leader over us? Tell us what to do. Go ahead.
When he was long before thrown out at the casting forth of the infants, him in the end, when they saw what came to pass, they admired.
They admired Moses in the end, even though they mocked him and said, this guy no leader of ours. He became a leader. He's crazy. Same thing.
That's right. It. So read Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 11 and 14.
Second Corinthians chapter 11, verse 14. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light.
Because in the beginning, Satan, he was transformed into a superhero, as a savior. You understand? No, it wasn't looking as Satan was. He was not
an ugly snake.
Right. He was not a snake, number one, and he was not a villain. He didn't look like he was a villain, but he was the villain. But he wasn't looked as a villain when Eve was dealing with him. All right. He was able to fool Eve. She thinking that he a savior. Or he got some knowledge of good or something like that. But he was the devil.
Exactly.
You understand? So it's the same thing here in this society. You know, a lot of you all, in your mind, you think that Esau is the savior. You know, but Esau, Edom, you understand? The scripture says he's that angel today that's transformed into a minister of light.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. All right? 100%. Now watch. I'm going to show you what Deacon Malachi just said. We seen this movie, Superman. Superman, all the kids, Superman! Watch, this is how the white man bewitches you, not knowing who's good or the hero or the villain. Watch this. Now, allegedly, I'm not even going to say nothing. This is Superman, and this is this General Zod is the villain. General Zod's the alleged villain. Watch what they say, though.
Look at this. We could have built a new Krypton in this squalor. You chose the humans over us. I exist only to protect Krypton. That is the sole purpose for which I was born. And every action I take, no matter how violent or how cruel, is for the greater good of my people.
then, I have no people. My soul, that is what you have taken from me.
Now, that was the point. General Zod in the movie is the villain, allegedly. But when you listen to him, he goes to Superman. He says, we could save our race. We could save our people. There's another part where Superman says, no, they had their chance. He rejects his entire race to stand with America and go against Zod. That's bewitching because that's subliminal messages. Go against your race, stand for the United States of America. And we're all in the theater, Superman! You're done. You're finished. Because in your mind, you will go against your people now.
Yeah, but Bishop, you remember when you talking to Sokol who got massacred, he said, my country. When we said, no, you are the Israelite, like, no, my country.
Right. And to go along with that, that scene, he shows him the image. He did Moses. He shows him everything. He goes, we're going to rebuild a new Krypton. He goes, what happens to Earth? And you see all the skulls. He goes, everything's built on something. Then Superman starts to sing, no, no, and he sings Cindy because he don't want to be part of that. Because he's on dry bone, he's on skulls under there. It's the same thing.
Right. Well, we go to 2 Corinthians 2 and 7 and read that. 2 Corinthians 2 and 7. Because this is how you gonna know who the wicked is today. The scripture tell you. All right, who the villain is. The scriptures tell you who the villain is. You know, in the movie we just watched there, Zod really is the hero. He fighting for his people. Superman, he's the villain. He go against his brother. He fighting his brother. He turn his back on his whole race of people. You know? Well, read that.
You said verse 7, Deacon?
Yes, verse 7 or 8.
2 Thessalonians 2 and verse 8. And then shall that wicked be revealed.
And then shall the villain be revealed. Read on.
Whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth.
And the Most High is going to consume him with the spirit of his mouth. The spirit of his mouth starts with us teaching who the villain is, who the wicked is. All right, read on.
And shall destroy with the brightness of his coming.
And the villain, he's going to be destroyed, the wicked. He's going to be destroyed when Christ returns with the brightness of his coming. All right? Christ going to come and he's going to show the whole planet Earth who the wicked is and he's going to destroy the wicked. He's going to destroy the villain of this whole story that our lives is made to play it in. You know, the villain on this whole planet Earth, Christ is going to destroy that villain. Yep.
So he's saying before he comes to destroy him, he says, all you preachers, all y'all got to do is reveal him. He said, I'm going to do the rest. Before you get that, Yahusop, in case, I know some of you church boys snuck up in here. In case you doubt that the white man is the wicked, give me Malachi 2. 2 to 4. This going, and you online. I know some of you church boys watching right now. No, the white man is not the wicked. Once you observe, you know his biblical name is Esau Edom. Watch this. Now we're going to see who the wicked is according to God. Come Malachi 2. Let's start 2 to 7. I'm sorry.
Malachi 2 and 4. And ye shall know that I have sent this.
Malachi.
2 to 4. I have
loved. Oh, did I say the wrong chapter? I'm sorry. Malachi chapter 1. That's my fault, Cap. You're right. Okay, I'll give you a pass now. Go ahead.
Malachi chapter 1. The burden of the word of the Lord to Israel by Malachi. I have loved you, saith the Lord. Yet ye say, wherein hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, saith the Lord? Yet I loved Jacob, and I hated Esau.
So the hero of the story is Jacob, whom God loves. The villain of the story is Esau, whom God hates. Read.
And laid his mountains and his heritage waste for the dragons of the wilderness.
This happened during the Middle Ages. Go ahead.
Whereas Edom saith, we are impoverished, but we will return and build the desolate places.
That happened during the Renaissance, 1453 on up. Go ahead.
Thus saith the Lord of hosts, they shall build, but I will throw down.
Esau shall build, but God says he will throw down. Go ahead.
And they shall call them.
They shall call Esau Edom.
The border of wickedness.
The border of wickedness, like it says in Thessalonians, it says, and then shall that wicked be revealed. Go ahead.
And the people.
The people, not the person, brothers. It says what, Isaac?
The people.
That means man, woman, boy, and girl.
Against whom the Lord hath indignation.
Whom the Lord has hatred. Go ahead.
Forever.
For how long?
Forever.
Forever and ever. So how do you know that indignation there means hatred? Verse 2 told you. It said, Jake, what did it say?
I have loved you, saith the Lord. Yet ye say, wherein hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother?
Here it comes.
Saith the Lord, yet I loved Jacob, and I hated Esau.
That's the indignation. That's the indignation. He hates Esau. You brothers, so we can't change this. We're either going to be a part of this history as the hero, or we're going to die serving the wicked, the exactly. true villain of this history.
Exactly. Now, I'm going to read real quick to show you how special you brothers are, you men that hold this power. Go back to that Thessalonians that you was reading, 2 Thessalonians 2 and 8.
2 Thessalonians 2 and 8. And then shall that wicked be revealed.
How is the wicked going to be revealed? Reveal means to uncover. How they going to be uncovered? How they going to be revealed? Through what? Huh? We read that earlier, the foolishness of preaching. But preaching what? Preaching the Quran? No. Preaching the Egyptian Book of the Dead? No. Preaching the word of the Most High, the Bible. Read that again.
And then shall that wicked be revealed.
Then shall the Bible reveal him. Go ahead.
Whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth.
This is that equivalent to that stick. This simple thing like the Bible that's in your regular Family Dollar stores. You find a Bible everywhere. This Bible is going to, in a hotel everywhere. This Bible going to bring this whole system down. Read it one more time.
And then shall that wicked be revealed.
Go ahead.
Whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth.
The Most High's word is going to consume all his lies. That's why I said that the earth opened up her mouth and swallowed it up. Because when we go and teach, we're swallowing up the lies that this beast have cast out to take and deceive the Israelites. Continue.
And shall destroy with the brightness of his coming.
So, and it shall, then after the word of the Most High is spoken, just like Moses with the stick, the Most High came and backed Moses up. Just like we bringing his word out, the angel's going to come back and back us up and destroy this whole system. One more scripture, Isaiah 13 and 3. Let's back that up. Let's see if it's saying the same thing. Isaiah 13 and 3. The word first, then the destruction. Let's see if it's saying the same thing. And who the Lord has given his power to? Us, the Power Rangers. I love that thing. You should have never opened your mouth, boy. Read.
Isaiah chapter 13, verse 3. I have commanded my sanctified ones.
The sanctified ones are the heroes that's being risen up, cleaned up from the garbage that Esau messed their minds up with. But we were being made illuminated because we were predestined to get this. When it was time to have those lights turn on, boom, you can't stop it. Read it again.
I have commanded my sanctified ones.
Sanctified ones, the clean ones. Go ahead.
I have also called my mighty ones for mine anger.
So while the sanctified ones are bringing the word out, the mighty ones are the angels backing it up with his anger. There it is again. One more. Amos 3. Villains, what? Superheroes and villains. Heroes, yeah. Heroes and villains. Thank you. Heroes and villains. Well, they they know what it is. You got it?
Yes, sir.
Amos 3, 6, and 7.
Amos chapter 3, verse 6.
Here we go again.
Shall a trumpet be blown in the city?
That's the Bible. That's the sanctified ones blowing the trumpet, the Bible. Shall the what?
Shall a trumpet be blown in the city? And the people not be afraid?
These Edomites are scared to death because they hear this word coming out. Go ahead.
Shall there be evil in a city and the Lord hath not done it?
So the Most High going to send the angels to back it up. Go ahead, read.
Surely the Lord God will do nothing.
The Most High ain't going to move. So that's the reason why Pastor Pork Chop can't do nothing. No matter who gets and try to teach the Bible, they can read it all their lives. The Lord ain't, the angels ain't moving on that. But when the sanctified ones get it, that's when the angels say, you know what? We have to activate. Go ahead.
Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants, the prophets.
So he gave us the illuminated ones that he's lighting up with the laws of the Most High, the teacher's word. Those are the ones that got the secrets to bring the system down through the Bible. And when we speak the words of the Most High, the angels have to activate. They were programmed to activate. He said, listen, when you hear my prophets bring that word out, you must go down and back them up. Bring the destruction that's coming out of that Bible, back them up.
So that goes with Isaiah 55 when he says, surely his word don't go out void.
Exactly. That's the point right there. The word do not go out void. When the prophets speak the word, the angels have to activate. That's what's going to bring the system down.
Yeah, you know, man, how you know the Bible is dangerous? Because white people looking at us, they say, how the hell they're able to break it down like that? This thing been inside the closet. This thing been in the garbage. How the hell they able to use these guns like that? There's one thing about white people you have to understand. They can talk evil all they want. One thing they're going to say, these guys know the Bible. Why would they say that? They speak evil of you, but they say, these guys that know the Bible. That don't make no sense.
That means the weapon is in the right owner's hands.
That's right.
The point.
Hey, didn't Adolf Hitler said, we have to destroy that book? Adolf Hitler, whose name was, what's his name, Schugelverver? Some crap.
Schugelverver, he said, we got, something like that.
When he went on his book burning campaign, the main book he wanted to get rid of was the Bible. Or what they call a Torah. Okay, he said, let's get rid of that book. Because once, remember Jesse Owens and them, when they won the race, he said, if these niggas get hold of that book, we in trouble. He said, burn that stuff. Hitler turned his back on us.
Yep. So what do they do? They go on the news and say, we found a tribe of Manasseh. Put 30 Asians on a plane.
Did y'all see that? They found a tribe of Manasseh with 20 Asians, 26 Asians. So that's the tribe of Manasseh.
He threw another shoe?
Yeah.
That's him throwing the shoe?
What the hell is this? Crazy. So
fear. Fear tactic.
Exactly. Like Deacon says, that is fear. Because we are waking up. They see us waking up and they can't stop it. Okay? That's in the scripture. So brothers, be glad we are the heroes of this story. Of God's program, we're the heroes. Y'all glad about that thing? Say aye.
Shalom. This is Bishop Nathaniel of Israel United in Christ. Please subscribe to our YouTube channels. Stay up to date with our latest events, music, and classroom lessons. IUIC plans to continue visiting different countries where this gospel has not been preached before. IUIC needs your help in pushing this truth. So join us, subscribe to our Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and podcast, and stay up to date with us. For more information, please visit www.israelunite.org.